And again, if we can welcome everyone in as quickly as possible to take your seats. Plenty of seats at the top, plenty of seats to the side. All right, good evening and welcome. This is the Santa Cruz County Community Hearing for the newly created Select Committee on South Bay Arrivals. I want to thank you all for being here. Before we begin, what I would like to do is introduce the members of the Select Committee. I'm just going to ask them to raise their hands as I call their names. There are 12 members of this Select Committee. Four were chosen by each of three different members of Congress. So, to begin, my name is Joe Simidian. I am the chair of the Santa Clara County, I am a member of the Santa Clara County Board of Supervisors, and I chair the Select Committee. Also from Congresswoman Anna Eshoo's district, we have Council Member Ann Wengert from the town of Portola Valley, and we have Council Member Mary Lynn Bernald. Mary Lynn, thank you. And we have Vice Mayor Gary Waldeck from the town of Los Altos Hills. Those are the four members who were selected by Congresswoman Eshoo or through an appointment process as she established it. We have four members as well from Santa Cruz County who were appointed by Congressman Sam Farr. They are familiar folks to most of you here, I'm sure. Supervisor Bruce McPherson and Supervisor John Leopold, who's seated right here. And I should mention that Supervisor Leopold is serving as one of our two vice chairs. We also have Council Member Don Lane from the City of Santa Cruz and Mayor Ed Bottorf from the City of Capitola. These are the four folks from here. And then appointed by Congresswoman Jackie Speer. Congresswoman Speer has appointed Supervisor Dave Pine, who advises me by text that he is stuck in traffic and will be along shortly. From the City of South San Francisco, we have Mayor Mark Adiego. Mayor Mark, please raise your hand. From the City of Foster City, Council Member Sam Hindy. Council Member, thank you. And arriving just on cue from the City of East Palo Alto is Vice Mayor Larry Moody. So these are the members of the Select Committee. And again, thank you all very much. All of these folks, just so you know, are listed on the back of the agenda. A number of you have asked how you can be in touch with members of the Select Committee. The answer is their emails are all there and readily available for any of you who wish to be in touch. And also with us tonight are a number of the alternates. There are, as I mentioned, 12 members of the Select Committee. There are also 12 alternates to make sure that to the greatest degree possible, we always have a full committee in place whenever we take up our deliberations. And I see a few of them are here with us tonight. So let me just look through the list, and I am sure that I saw George Purnell, who is the president of the Happy Valley School Board. Thank you for being here, George. Council Member Jean Mardot from the City of Los Altos. And and with us from my colleague, Supervisor Mike Wasserman's office, is his staff representing the supervisor. Please raise your hand and let folks know that you're here. And then, right there in front of me. Thank you. Donna Lind is the mayor of the City of Scotts Valley, and she is the alternate for Bruce McPherson, so you are doubly represented by virtue of her presence. Thank you. I'll need to look right in front of me a little bit more. All right. Want to offer just a few thanks before we begin, and also, frankly, I'm going to just kill a minute or two here to let a few more folks make their way in so that when we start, we're fully in place. A quick thank you to the City of Santa Cruz, both the manager and the council member who are hosting us here in the Civic Auditorium. A thanks as well to Supervisors McPherson and Leopold and their staffs who did much of the heavy lifting to make tonight possible. And just a word or two of explanation about who the Select Committee on South Bay Arrivals is and what our task is. And let me just begin by looking all the way up under the letter E right in front of me in the back. Can you hear loud and clear up at the top?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Probably a poor question to ask in this crowd, but I wanted to make sure. The Select Committee is an unusual creation, and I want to be very clear at the outset. We have no office, we have no staff, we have no budget, and we have no authority. All right? That being said, we were established by the three members of Congress, Congressman Farr, Congresswoman Eshoo, and Congresswoman Speer, the three members of Congress, all of whom have their staff here tonight because they're all back in Washington. We were established by these three members of Congress as a select committee with a very specific responsibility, and it was to hear from the FAA about their feasibility study, what they thought they were capable of doing in connection with the noise problem that brings us all here tonight, to hear from the public as well about those proposals, and then to assess them, to judge them, to evaluate them, and to report back to the three members of Congress and to the FAA with our opinions, our conclusions about the potential remedies for the noise problem that you all have experienced. We're hoping to be able to do that by consensus, but this is early days and we will see as we go how much of a consensus develops. We know there are going to be a range of views. We want to make sure they all get heard in this process. If at any point there's a concern that some voice is not being heard, please let us know. I assure you the attempt is to make sure that every voice gets heard before the select committee sits down, rolls up its sleeves, and says, all right, what do we think of the proposals? What do we think based on what we've heard from the community? I should mention that the meeting is being filmed by Community TV. Want to thank the county again for that. It will be broadcast in the coming weeks. And as I mentioned a moment ago, after we hear from the FAA, we will then be in a position to receive public input about the feasibility study. Many of you know, but just to reiterate, this is the first of three scheduled hearings, one in each of the three counties, Santa Cruz, Santa Clara, and San Mateo counties. And we're going to begin our work this evening by asking the FAA to make a presentation to us about its study. And just to be clear, and this is a sort of a formal construct, but they will be presenting to us, the select committee. That will be followed by a brief opportunity for the select committee to ask technical and clarifying questions. I'm going to ask all of the committee members to help make sure that they are brief and that they are just technical and clarifying questions so we can get on to hearing from you, the members of the community. When we get to that point, we have a half an hour set aside for up to four of the established community airport noise groups to speak to the select committee. We have reached out to, there are probably a half a dozen to a dozen such groups, depending on who you count and how you count, but four of them have taken us up on the opportunity to speak tonight. They'll each have 7 minutes. That will allow us to get through those comments within a half an hour. Again, an opportunity, committee members, for some follow-up questions once we've heard from the four community groups, and then we're going to go to you and ask you if you'd like to come and speak and share your thoughts. Again, our focus is on what we can or cannot recommend to the members of Congress who have impaneled this group and to the FAA in terms of a going forward strategy to fix the problem that is currently in place. I think all of that is clear from a process standpoint. The remaining community-based noise groups will be scheduled at our two other community meetings in June, as I said. We are going to give everybody an opportunity to speak tonight, but in order to get a rough sense of how long that might take, I want to do a couple of things to facilitate the meeting. And I'm looking to the committee members to make sure this works for all of you. One is, when a group comes forward to make their presentation, one of the four groups, I'm going to ask those of you who think you are aligned with that group, or if you are a member of that group, whatever that means, to simply raise your hand. So we will then get a quick sense. And look, one person can speak wisdom, so don't worry too much about the nose counting, but at least we'll have a rough sense that you're here with whatever group you are aligned with, if any. After this, the remarks, I'm going to ask you to raise your hands if you more or less would like to support the point of view that was articulated. Just give us, again, a quick head count so we sort of get a sense for what the level of support or interest or enthusiasm is. After we get through the four groups, we're going to go to you and we're going to ask you to come. Now, by my count, there are roughly 400 to 450 folks who are here tonight. If each of you spoke for 3 minutes, and particularly if each of you spoke for 3 minutes and said, it's bad and I'm mad, I'm not sure that's the best use of your time, never mind our time. The thing I want to commit to you is, I don't know how long everybody can stay, but I will be here until the last person has spoken. So do not be concerned that you are not going to get heard. And again, we are recording, and so we'll have a permanent record of what you have to say for consideration as we go along. That being said, we're going to be passing out the speaker cards, and if you have one, in a minute we'll ask you to raise your hand so it can get picked up. If you haven't gotten one, we of course have more. But just let me get a quick sense of how many of you think you are going to want to address the committee tonight. A show of hands, please. Okay. I'm going to say 90 seconds, a minute and a half. Does that work for the committee?
Yeah, I think that's right.
All right, and I'm hoping that'll get you back to your homes and your families and your lives a little bit quicker. And a piece of advice somebody gave me once, which I try to follow but not always successfully, is remember that phrase, topic sentence, from high school English class. It has served us well. So enough of the brief overview. What I want to do now is ask the FAA to please come up and to give us an initial presentation. I'm going to exhort the FAA, as I always do, to please try and make their presentation in the closest thing to plain English as you possibly can. I understand that this is technical, I understand it's complex, and we certainly have a bunch of folks in the community who have ramped up their understanding and expertise in a very impressive way over the last difficult year. But in order to make sure everybody gets the benefit of the input from the FAA to us, we are going to ask that you do it in as close to plain English in layman's terms as you possibly can. So let me ask Mr. Glenn Martin from the FAA to please introduce himself and begin the presentation. And we are hoping that in 15 or 20 minutes, we'll be able to take some technical and clarifying questions from the committee. Mr. Martin, welcome.
Thank you. Good evening. I am glad to be here with you today to talk about the FAA's Northern California Noise Initiative feasibility study and, of course, the complexities of the issues associated with it. Before I begin, I want to take a moment to thank Congressmembers Eshoo, Farr, and Speer and their staffs for working so diligently to set up the select committee. I also want to thank you, Chairman Simidian, and all of the honorable members for your time commitment to this, to take this task into your hands, and also for inviting me here to speak with you as you kick this off. I certainly want to thank the residents for coming. I know that this has been impactful to your lives, and the FAA is standing ready for you to give your input and to work with the select committee so that the FAA can receive the recommendations and move forward to address these issues. It is no secret that in society we are modernizing and it's happening all around us. Technology companies are innovating at lightning speed, and products that were considered the stuff of science fiction just a few years ago are rapidly becoming commonplace in our culture. Transportation is also modernizing. The needs, the modes, and the capabilities that we are implementing are evolving as well. Not far from here, Google is test driving vehicles on city streets under real-world conditions. Throughout the country, unmanned aircraft, we call them drones, are being used for everything from movie making to pipeline inspections. And this year, we expect there will be up to 50 licensed commercial space operators in the United States. That's up from just 3 that were licensed in 2012. If you've gotten as old as I have and never thought you were going to go to space, I think you need to start rethinking that. We are working to integrate drones into the national airspace system. We're evolving in how we ensure companies we regulate are complying with the rules, and we're improving the way we control the thousands upon thousands of passenger and cargo aircraft that pack our skies every day of the year. From coast to coast, the FAA is upgrading the nation's air traffic control system and improving the safety, the efficiency, reliability, and the availability of air transportation in the United States. And perhaps no other region better demonstrates the need for a modernized system than the region that is represented here tonight. Innovation moves at the speed of imagination, and this region is a world leader in dreaming up and creating amazing ideas and products. The Bay Area is one of the world's great centers of innovation, research, and academic thought, as well as a tourism destination for people throughout the globe. The need to integrate the vast riches here with the rest of the United States and the rest of the world is paramount. And modernizing our air traffic control system is key to achieving this goal, and this program has been underway nationwide for almost a decade. You are probably familiar with the name of the program, the Next Generation Air Transportation System, or NextGen. Among other things, NextGen includes new computer systems, receiver stations and digital communications, as well as new satellite-based air routes. Much of the program is invisible to both the traveling public and the residents of communities near and under flight paths. A few of the examples of this are that last year we finished deploying powerful new computer systems at all of our en route centers that control high altitude traffic in the continental United States. This computer system is a key element in the NextGen Foundation, and it gives us the technological horsepower to support other key programs. We're also busy installing the new computer systems at the approach controls. These are the facilities that which control airplanes as they are arriving or departing from the airports. Additionally, we have finished installing more than 600 ground transceivers that will help move us from a radar-based air traffic system to a satellite-based system. And meanwhile, we're deploying new digital communications at many of our control towers. These systems replace certain voice communications between pilots and controllers. Operating much like text messages, these systems ease congestion on our frequencies, speeds the giving of clearances between controller and pilot, and reduces the potential for misunderstanding critical safety information. New satellite-based procedures are probably the most recognized part of our modernization system. Or modernization program. More than 7,000 satellite-based procedures are operating today in our skies, and they now outnumber traditional radar-based procedures. There are many more other elements of NextGen, but I don't want to elaborate on those now. I do want to stress that the changes we're making today are laying the foundation for even more improvements down the road. For example, the precision of satellite-based navigation will allow us to create smoother and more efficient flows of aircraft into capacity-constrained areas by scheduling planes to be at a certain point at a certain time. We've already begun employing this in a number of places, including Houston, and we will expand it to other locations as the system capabilities increase. No modernization effort is without its challenges, especially in places like Northern California, which has some of the most complex airspace in the country. While the vast number of satellite-based procedures nationwide have been implemented seamlessly, we know that a few have generated controversy, and we come here to be sensitive to the community's concerns, and we want to work hard to address them where possible. Our Northern California Noise Initiative began in response to concerns that citizens in Santa Cruz, Santa Clara, San Mateo, and San Francisco counties expressed about both long-standing noise issues and some of the changes we made to the Northern California arrival and departure procedures. The FAA has received a number of recommendations for new and modified flight procedures from community members, from municipalities, from your cities, and from various groups, some of whom the Select Committee will hear from tonight. With support of this region's congressional leadership, The FAA developed a detailed plan of action to explore the proposed remedies that we received. The FAA thoroughly reviewed all of the specific proposals and recommendations. The steps in this review included a detailed analysis, flyability assessment, operational assessment, and finally a feasibility determination. What this means is our team, which included the controllers from here in the local area, focused on whether the proposals met FAA safety criteria, whether they could be flown by the fleet mix that services the Bay Area, and we also assessed the proposals' impacts to surrounding airports and traffic flows. The feasibility determination was made after all the aspects of this study were completed and were considered in that determination. So given that many of the proposals were either similar, tried to address the same concerns, perhaps tried to solve the same problem from either end, we were able to kind of group them into six categories of the ones we found feasible. The first area is in airspace design changes that would ensure safety. At major airports, the FAA creates highly controlled airspace in order to protect those busy flows of traffic into and out of those airports. And we found that in the case of San Francisco, that protected airspace is not capturing the aircraft as they arrive into San Francisco in a manner that we feel gives them the best chance to fly what we hope to achieve, which is an optimal profile descent. This type of descent offers the aircraft a chance to idle, reduce to idle power, and glide down, which we do hope will help with some of the noise concerns that people have raised. We have already begun the process of reviewing this highly controlled airspace and working through the modification process. The second area is making adjustments to arrival procedures over the South Bay, and that's including the surfer. We hope that this committee, and with the help and input from the community, will help identify improvements and provide guidance from the regional perspective on how we can either improve the surfer or where the track fits better within your region. The third area is making adjustments to use existing departure procedures better during nighttime operations. When the aircraft departs and it's on a filed route, often we turn those aircraft and point them either more toward their destination, point them more toward the direction they're wanting to go, and the recommendations are if you leave them on the filed route, they may actually mitigate some of the concerns that people are experiencing because we took them off that route. The fourth area of feasibility is actually amending the departure procedures. Again, this was largely due to concerns overnight. So we have departure procedures that we use during the night, and they're actually asking us to look at the nighttime departures off San Francisco, trying to make them better by actually creating new routes that turn southbound either over the bay or up around the bay to improve the distance that they're out over the water before they come back over land, hoping to gain the altitude or take them around different areas in order to address the noise concerns brought to us. The fifth area is evaluating and adjusting Oakland and San Francisco departures. Both San Francisco and Oakland departures predominantly depart out over the bay, and this creates a dependency that does shape and guide the flight paths as they turn and proceed southbound. So these suggestions involve trying to keep the departures either over the water or adjusting the flight path to help align these aircraft so that when they do turn southbound, they're adjusted to a better place coming back over the land and heading southbound, or have more altitude before they reach back over the shoreline coming back. The sixth area is improving aircraft setup and sequencing between facilities. This area would improve the flow management of the arrivals. The FAA doesn't control airline scheduling, so they schedule to come in to the airport at whatever time they do, and largely they believe you all want to get here at 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock. So they schedule, they depart, and then we sort them out when they get here. So this area really helps us try and improve our flow management of that, helping to have them arrive here when capacity is available, thus requiring less controller instructions to aircraft at lower altitudes, for example, turning them, trying to use speed restrictions, those types of things, leveling them off. If we can make those improvements, it may, again, allow them to fly a more optimal profile descent, and I hope that this would be able to address issues like speed brakes, powering up when they level off, or turning and making more of an impact of noise or generating more noise when they make these maneuvers. The feasibility report has been provided to both the Select Committee and also to the San Francisco Community Noise Roundtable. We anticipate the Select Committee will accept public input, review FAA proposals, and make recommendations on issues identified in the FAA's initiative with a focus on arrival issues that primarily impact the South Bay region. Additionally, we believe the San Francisco Airport Community Roundtable will also accept public input, review the proposals, and make recommendations on issues identified in the initiative with a focus on the San Francisco departures and arrivals that primarily impact the San Francisco Roundtable geographic area. I hope that both the Select Committee and the Roundtable will continue to collaborate so that no one's issues are left out, especially if someone feels like they're in between the two. I hope that we can find the right body, whether you wish to take that issue on or whether we make it clear to have the Roundtable look at it. But it's my desire that the community have someone that they can count on to hear their issue and work through it. It is important to note that once a regional vetted recommendation is presented to the FAA, we will still and must conduct all required safety and environmental reviews before implementing any changes. Again, I want to thank you for the opportunity to be here today. I want to thank you and the community for the work that you're doing, and I look forward to finding answers and solutions to these sensitive and complex issues.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. Thank you very much. Before we go to the committee members, let me just thank those of you who are late arrivals and also ask a couple of quick questions just to make sure we know who's here as we have the conversation. If you are a resident of Santa Cruz County, would you raise your hand, please? Okay. Hands down. If you are a resident of Santa Clara County, would you raise your hands, please? Okay. Thank you. Okay. If you are a resident of San Mateo County, would you please raise your hands? A small number, okay. And I have not forgotten, residents of Monterey County, are you here as well? We have a handful, okay. All right, and anyone who ventured from another county other than those four? Okay, you would. I'm going to ask you not to ask the gentleman a quick question because he's interacting with the Select Committee and there is a reason for that, sir. But if you get your questions or comments in on the comment card a little later, we'll try and make sure they get addressed. So let me turn to the Select Committee now and see if there are technical or clarifying questions at this point before we hear from the four community noise groups who are going to be teed up in just a moment. Committee members? Let me go to Councilmember Gary Waldeck, who is from Los Altos Hills. Let me welcome Dave Pine, County Supervisor from San Mateo County. And let me welcome Peter Otaki, a council member from Menlo Park, who is an alternate. Mr. Waldeck.
Thank you, Mr. Smidian. Glenn, one of the things that I've heard here tonight is
a little louder. You're going to need to just take that microphone right up.
I speak very softly. I kill microphones, so if it goes away, please forgive me. It's all my fault. Mr. Martin, one of the things you and I spoke about earlier, and I did not hear addressed in here tonight is, I applaud your effort to work with the community to try to figure out the best way to solve everybody's problems. I'm not sure we're going to ever get that point, but to minimize the impact, perhaps. One of the things I believe that we have a real problem with is the measurement system you're using, i.e. the A weighting as defined in the FAA spec. A weighting, in effect, masks all low-frequency noise, which is kind of what we're all hearing. And as a result, you will always pass the noise test. Do you have any comment on that and what we might do about it?
So the FAA has certainly taken a lot of feedback on those metrics and the way that we measure noise. And you know, to explain the research and the length of time that's going to take is just aggravating. So what the FAA's proposal is to come out and do things like this. We're not going to have noise metrics in time to make the changes that need to be made here. What we need is you, your help in helping formulate this community input into helping us understand where these impacts are and where solutions may be that we can improve things for what's happening. The FAA is committed to continuing the research and try and identify these and improve our modeling and so forth, but I don't want this group to wait for that to happen.
Thank you. All right. I perhaps should have mentioned earlier, the 12 members of the committee have had an opportunity by telephone conference call, as well as the alternates, to participate in a technical briefing reviewing much of this material. So it is not the first time most of us have heard this information. So if you're surprised by the lack of questions, please don't be. That indicates that people were listening when we had the two telephone conference calls. Let me just ask a couple of leading questions that I think are important for the community to be aware of and for us to refocus on, if I may, Mr. Martin. One is, the feasibility analysis that you have presented to this select committee and which we are now evaluating is based primarily on suggestions you received from the community and members of Congress over the course of the last year plus. Is that right?
I believe the first meetings were in July, not to split hairs on how long it's been, but from July. And then we did receive them either through the three meetings of which we met through the congressional offices, and then we certainly had follow-up input from people that were at those meetings.
Great. And you received a number of recommendations which were then taken by the FAA for consideration and analysis, and you are reporting back to our select committee on what you think is feasible among those recommendations, yes?
Yes.
How many recommendations did you receive and analyze? Do you remember?
I believe it was around 57 suggestions.
And some of those were deemed to be not feasible, some of them were deemed to be feasible, and some of them were deemed to be not applicable or relevant to the problem at hand. Is that a fair summary?
Yes.
And so now you've come back and you've said, we think there are six clusters of changes that might be deemed feasible. You are presenting us with those six sets of feasibility analyses and asking us what we think of those six sets of feasible actions. Fair enough?
Yes.
Okay. To not to speak for the community, who will speak for itself in a moment or two, but I think to put all this in its most simple terms, people are asking, what happened that made it bad? What can you do to make it better? And how can we be convinced that the things you want to do will make it better? That's a gross oversimplification of a lot of work. You've given us these six items. Part of the reason I asked folks who was here is because while you're testifying to the full committee, I heard optimizing profile descent. I'm going to be the non-technical person and want to make sure I understand it. Is that there's a way in which aircraft are supposed to enter and make their way through the airspace, and if that isn't working for us, it means they have to go into a number of maneuvers and alternative approaches that create noise. Is that a fair summary of a very technical issue?
That is a fair summary. If I may add, that
please.
Doesn't mean that the optimal profile descent doesn't create noise, but these maneuvers certainly create different noise or additional noise.
And the second issue that you referenced, and you know, a lot of people in this room have come to know what Surfer and Big Sur are, but not everybody does. I took to be, to grossly oversimplify again, you've received some suggestions that it used to involve planes coming this way, now it involves planes going this way, and there's a suggestion to put it back the way it was. Is that what the second group of recommendations was about?
Yes.
Thank you. And no. Hang on, gang, please. We want to make our, we really are just trying to clarify here. We aren't in the Roman arena here, so bear with me, please. Items 3 and 4 both had to do with the extent to which, again, as I understood it as a layperson, the extent to which aircraft, when they're in the vicinity of SFO, either do or don't manage to stay on the assigned path during the course of the evening, 1 to 6. Is that, again, understanding I'm grossly oversimplifying because I'm trying to get us to focus on these things, is that a fair summary of what you were just telling us? And if you want to elaborate, please do.
Okay. The third one was around the established procedures and taking them off of those procedures in order to turn them to the south, in many cases, say, earlier than the route would have taken them. So the question is, if you leave them on the routes longer, who's impacted? Is that less impact? Is that a mitigation to the problem we're trying to solve? The fourth issue is around actually looking at the procedures that we use during the night and see whether or not there aren't ways to turn these. Obviously, these are all aircraft that turn south. And so this is a request to look at the procedures we're using at night and seeing if we couldn't develop new procedures that perhaps use the bay more. There's a discussion around actually turning and coming down the bay. San Francisco's departures don't do that. There's no procedure that brings them south down the bay.
Okay.
Largely because San Jose is kind of in the way. So this is at night, though, we may be able to do something like that to help mitigate the turn that's turning left over the peninsula and coming back to the south.
All right. Is it fair to say that those last two, numbers 3 and 4, would have minimal, if any, impact on Santa Cruz County? That items 1 and 2 are more likely to have some impact on Santa Cruz County than items 3 and 4? Or have I missed the point there?
I would think that Santa Cruz County would want to be aware if we were making any of those changes and want to know what the expected impact could be. I don't want to say they're going to assume there's no impact. I would want to share what that impact was and let them make the judgment.
Okay. And then 5 and 6, if you could recap those again briefly. When we talk about sequencing, this is, as I understand it and as I've heard you articulate it, this is about creating essentially an orderly line or path that actually works. Is that, again,
sure,
a fair layman's summary?
So if I may, number 5, the departures from San Francisco and Oakland depart both out over the bay, and they're trying to turn and come south. That interaction helps determine where the fixes are that they fly over, where they turn, and so forth. So the question is, if you move those points around in the bay or move them north or move them south, that will affect the people on the peninsula that are impacted when the departures come back around to the south. So that's number 5. Can you look at that and can we find better places for those fixes, knowing there's an interaction there? Number 6 is around sequencing. Because of the scheduling, and this isn't to blame the airlines, we're here to work the issue, but because of the scheduling and the fact that they come in many times in clusters, we believe through automation, and we're using this, as I mentioned, in some places, you can now begin to say, we want you to reach these points along your route at a certain time. And by doing that, it allows far less clumping which is occurring right now, you know, north of Capitola, and that's why you see so many aircraft vectored off of the approach or off the path and to the west and so forth, and S turns and things. So if they come up here sequenced in a way that minimizes that, we believe the effects of those controller actions or eliminating those controller actions could have a reduction on the impacts that those are, the noise that that's being generated from that.
All right. Let me thank you for your patience with my follow-up questions. Let me thank the committee as well. Let me thank the public as well. I'll ask the public later, either in person after the meeting or with their comments or by email, to let me know whether those questions actually did clarify or if they just cost us 10 minutes, and that's on me. Back to the committee. Any follow-up clarifying questions, technical questions? Vice Mayor Moody from the City of East Palo Alto.
Thank you, Chair Smidian. Glenn, oftentimes when we begin thinking about the airports that are impacting our three counties, we talk heavily about San Francisco and San Jose. And once again, you mentioned Oakland. In Oakland, we know their activity has increased tremendously over the years. We talk about Oakland from a departure standpoint, but are there arrivals that are going into Oakland that are impacting our three counties as well?
I'm not sure I have a definite answer for that. I would certainly bring that answer back to you. I mean, obviously, the flights that are coming from overseas or Hawaii are going to have to cross over to get to Oakland. So I certainly agree that, you know, there must be some out there. The majority of flight tracks we see, of course, into Oakland, which is not quite the international hub that San Francisco is. The majority are all domestic or coming from the east, southeast. But I'll find what the arrival tracks are from the west. I just don't know them right offhand.
Thank you.
Thank you. And we appreciate your willingness and ability to share that information following the meeting sometime over the course of the next few weeks or months. Supervisor Leopold and then Supervisor McPherson.
Glenn, thanks for the presentation and the briefing you gave us the other day. I'm just trying to get clarity whether the ground tract is Surfer or Big Sur. Is there a possibility of looking about what happens before they get on those ground tracks over the water? And could that make a difference in the impact that, that we're feeling here on the land?
I think that if you're asking, can a lot of that sequencing be moved out of the over the water, I'm not sure I would suggest that that's going to alleviate this. Given the methodology of the air traffic system, they're going to be fairly close to the airport. That's when you're actually trying to put them at a minimum separation level. And so that's always going to require that person fine-tuning the arrival. You know, they may have two or three, four arrival streams of aircraft coming in that they're trying to line up on that final. So there's always going to be that last fine-tuning that's done. I think the time-based flow management that I mentioned is the biggest thing that would eliminate some of that vectoring there at the close-in airports, or close into the airport.
Thank you.
Supervisor McPherson.
Thank you. We were appointed to discuss remedies that do not impose a hardship on other Santa Cruz County residents or throughout the whole region. When we moved when the flight path was moved from a Surfer to the next gen, it went to some mountain areas that are 3,000 feet higher, and it seemed like the flight patterns were coming in lower, and maybe because that's because of the OPD. My very simple question is, could raising the altitude, is that of the planes, because I think there's been a contraction of where they're coming over, it's 2,000 feet higher and they're coming in 2,000 or more feet lower. If we raise the height of the airplane in its descent, is that possible? And what of an impact would that have on the safety concerns?
My thought is if we're talking about out near where they cross over the bay on the land, okay? The altitudes that you're talking about, I don't believe are as big a safety concern as they are efficiency. If the aircraft requires to start at a certain altitude in order to do that optimal descent, there is actually a window that we give all the aircraft, because almost every aircraft flies at a different angle down. So there is a window there, is what we call it. There's several altitudes that they can start at. So it's not so much a safety issue as a efficiency issue. So to answer your question, obviously you can reduce the amount of efficiency you have. The questions become a little more complicated when you get down their final approach. Aircraft require stability, and that stability has a fairly fine-tuned angle to the runway. And so once you get closer in, you know, that ability to move them any significant altitude, you know, lessens almost to the point of not being able to help them. Was that even close to plain language?
Thank you. We'll by the time we get done with this process, we'll all be able to speak in the jargon of the FAA, and the FAA will all be able to speak in the plain English of the community, and that'll be a good thing for us all. So let me say thank you.
You're
to the committee.
You're giving me too much credit, Chairman.
I want to ask the committee to hold off on further clarifying questions or comments, because I want to get to community input. We've been keeping folks, and they've been very patient. We have four groups, and you'll see them on your agenda. Thank you, Mr. Martin. We have four groups that are on the agenda to speak, and I'm going to ask them to come up and speak in this order. Save Our Skies, Santa Cruz County, followed by Quiet Skies, Los Altos Hills, followed by Save Our Skies, Monterey County, followed by San Lorenzo Valley Advocacy Group. And to the committee members and the members of the public, as I mentioned earlier, we have reached out to every group that we have identified as a bona fide community noise group and asked them if they would like to present, and tried to schedule them at one of the three meetings which was convenient for them. Some of them, not all of them, chose to participate at a time and place that was in the community where most of their membership resides. Others said, nope, that's not a priority to us. We'd rather do it at a different time or at a different place. We're asking each one to present just once because they're trying to present to us, not to the three different communities. We've got a half an hour set aside, so 7 minutes for each. If you're concerned that a community group with which you are affiliated hasn't been approached, I'm going to direct you to my capable staff person, Chris Zanardi. She's got the list of community groups. She can make sure that we've reached out to the group that you're concerned about, but we have reached out to at least another four or five and are in the process of scheduling them to make a presentation so that the committee hears from each and every one of the community groups. So let me ask the representative from Save Our Skies, Santa Cruz County, to introduce himself, to make his presentation. We have a timekeeper over here who will flash a yellow card when you get to 30 seconds left, and then when that red card goes up, you know what that means. Thank you for your willingness to participate and for preparing to present to the select committee. Welcome.
Thank you very much. My name is Patrick Meyer, and I'm co-chair of Save Our Skies Santa Cruz County.
And again, and I should have mentioned this before, I had the privilege of representing much of Santa Cruz County for 8 years in the California State Senate. I know what a wonderfully demonstrative community it is, but I want to create a place where everybody is comfortable whether they agree or disagree. And I worry a little bit when we get too enthusiastic that that'll cramp the style for folks who have a different point of view, which we want to hear. So if I can ask you to keep the enthusiasm down, I think that will help make sure everybody's point of view is respected. I will just ask, repeat the name of the group, please.
Save Our Skies, Santa Cruz County.
If you consider yourself a member of the group, would you raise your hands? Great, thank you very much. And when we get done, we'll sort of ask for folks to indicate whether or not they are roughly in alignment with the point of view that's expressed. Proceed, thank you.
All right, thank you very much. Members of the Select Committee and the community, thank you for inviting us to speak tonight. I won't remind you of the pain and the grief that my friends and my neighbors have been enduring over the past 14 months. However, I will ask that you help ensure our Santa Cruz will never become a doormat for San Francisco International Airport. I'm here to outline the response that Save Our Skies Santa Cruz County has developed. The initiative and feasibility study are products of a series of meetings Save Our Skies and the FAA have had over the last year. Save Our Skies has been working in collaboration with other community groups throughout the Bay Area and has continued to refine our asks to the FAA. A thorough technical response to the FAA's Phase 1 initiative is not really possible given the 7 minutes that I have for today. So we're going to keep our responses at about 15,000 feet, which I think is a relief for everyone here tonight. The regional solution is the result of our collaboration with other communities, and we ask that you give this your full attention and support. The feasibility study contains many suggestions that did not come from Save Our Skies Santa Cruz or the regional group collaboration. Here, though, I will address the points we feel are relevant to correcting the next-gen issues. In reviewing this feasibility study, we urge the Select Committee to consider immediate solutions for immediate relief and long-range solutions for peace in our region. We recommend that the Select Committee instruct the FAA to restore the historical flight path to a pre-next-gen environment. We call on the FAA to address both near-term impacts that were a direct result of next-gen changes made on March 5th, such as the surfer flight procedure, and those ongoing longer-term cumulative impacts that have occurred in other communities highlighted by the oppressive conditions from multiple converging procedures over the summit area and over Palo Alto. We also believe, given how sophisticated and advanced the FAA is and what flight procedures are capable of performing these days, that an approach can be developed that is quieter than the original Big Sur procedure that Surfer replaced on March 5th. In fact, we demand it. With Select Committee guidance, the FAA seems to be willing to make this happen. We further recommend that the historical flight path pre-next-gen be reinstated not only to respect a 35-year-old navigation easement where the flight path always was, but in particular to give relief to the most significantly impacted communities at the summit. There, the surfer procedure simply makes a strafing run up the summit skyline roads, often crossing at about 3,500 feet, right over many homes. Improved flight procedures will provide some relief, but at the summit, the diminishing returns are more pronounced. The FAA's careless actions have, in some ways, pitted members of our community against each other, and we find this shameful. Let's optimize Surfer not to shave off a few seconds of SFO arrival times, but to respect the many communities that Surfer impacts along its route. Here's our specific responses to the feasibility study. First, page 11, PBN procedures. Transitioning Surfer to an improved Big Sur flight path is a solution that is much better for all parties concerned. We believe that this will restore our skies to the pre-next-gen environment over Santa Cruz County. However, the altitude must be raised. The last item on page 11 states, quote, it was instead suggested that these altitudes be adjusted in order to allow for OPD, or optimized profile descent, end quote. Please ask the FAA, what those altitudes are, and please define this. We'd like to know what the FAA's definition is of OPD. What does it mean to them from an engineering sense? This restoration will have a domino effect on flight paths over subsequent communities at the summit and all the way to SFO. This change should allow the BRICS route to be adjusted. We strongly urge the Select Committee to have the FAA revisit the BRICS flight procedure that is causing unbearable pain to the residents of the Summit and Skyline areas. Second, page 18, Class B containment. We, Save Our Skies Santa Cruz County, do not support the FAA proposal to amend the SFO Class B airspace to contain all procedures. This is a band-aid to make up for what is a poorly designed procedure. Please reference page 17 of the study. Surfer cannot fly OPD. Third, page 17, the use of descent via. In theory, this is a good thing, but we know they can't fly Surfer at an optimized OPD. So it will be noise producing. We ask that you not consider this as a feasible option. Since the creation of the initial proposal, the initiative process has continued to develop, and we have worked to fine-tune our original proposal, which is before you today. We believe the feasibility study is a good faith effort. Yet there is room for improvement. In addition, Save Our Skies Santa Cruz County would ask for more transparency in this process. It is noted that in the executive summary that our congressional representatives will be given a report explaining why specific asks were deemed unfeasible. We recommend the select committee get a copy of that report and make it available to the public. In closing, we recommend the select committee consider the regional proposal as the source for positive change. SOSC will deliver the select committee a letter and report expanding on our analysis of the feasibility study. Thank you for your concerns and your commitment to saving our community.
Thank you. If you would like to register your support, if you just raise your hand, if that feels like a set of observations you'd like to support. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's bring our next group up, Quiet Skies, Los Altos Hills, and let's ask the representative to make their way to the podium. We have some technical assistance here we're going to provide over our shoulders.
Yes.
And committee members, we may want to scooch to the left and the right in order to be able to see the presentation. If you need to pick up your chairs and move, please feel free to do so. And meanwhile, if our presenter will identify himself and his organization.
My name is Bill Evans. I'm here to represent Quiet Skies Los Altos Hills. Thank you for the opportunity to present this evening. I'm from a place that can't give a presentation without slides. I'm at a disadvantage. I choose Hulu. It's the PowerPoint application, second from right.
There's your problem.
Okay. So thank you for the opportunity to present to you this evening. Perhaps so, but let me just say that I represent Quiet Skies Los Altos Hills. We're a part of the Quiet Skies Mid-Peninsula Coalition. 64% of the persons who report noise to the SFO come from the Mid-Peninsula area, according to stopjetnoise.net. In February, six cities on the Mid-Peninsula reached consensus on four principles. These principles were: noise is more important than airline efficiency, noise must be measured, the process of air traffic control change must be transparent, and changes must be neighborly. One can't simply focus on what's right for one's individual tiny community like Los Altos Hills. We combined these principles into a letter to Eshoo and Farr on March 3rd, and you can see that letter on our website. That letter was from Quiet Skies Mid-Peninsula. The Mid-Peninsula has a special noise problem. While SFO arrivals are up 10%, the planes that overfly the Mid-Peninsula to land at SFO have increased by 25% since 2010. We get SFO arrivals not just from the south, not just from Surfer, but from the north and the west as well. We've had NOID advocacy groups working in our geography since 2011 with not much result. We believe that the FAA proposals that were presented on last Monday do not target Mid-Peninsula problems. Of the 46 proposals considered by the FAA, 13 were deemed feasible. We support 10 of those 13 proposals. We support three strongly. One we support conditionally, and two we think require further study. I'll get back to the conditional support issue in a moment. We think a fundamental problem with the FAA is they do not address noise directly. Gary, maybe you could step in for me. The FAA report issued last Monday focuses on procedural changes, changes on routes and altitudes. They don't have any noise reduction target. They don't commit to any improvement. They don't commit to even measuring what the noise is. And I appreciate when Glenn says they don't have the infrastructure to do it, but I disagree that it would take a full year to put that into place. Instead, they depend on citizen complaints. The models that they use are obsolete. Day-night averaging and A-weighting might be relevant to aircraft manufactured in the 1970s, but not today. And the very fact that the FAA models predicted no noise impact in the move to next-gen proves that their models are simply wrong. The FAA reiterates in their report that efficiency trumps noise. And Glenn, who is the assignee to present the strategy, talks several times about the importance of efficiency. We are not the airlines. We are the people on whom junk noise is being dumped by the airlines. I recall to you that the Aeronautics Information Manual ranks safety top, aircraft noise second, and airline efficiency third. We simply ask the FAA to implement the existing FAA policy. We're disappointed that the FAA evaluated only a handful of remedies. The lowering of the Class B airspace, interesting. The Surfer route changes are interesting. But on the other hand, only 28% of the planes that overfly the Mid-Peninsula are on the Surfer procedure. We were disappointed that the FAA would not evaluate the proposals from Mid-Peninsula. We want the FAA to use airspace over the oceans. For example, Northern arrivals that come down the Point Reyes 1 arrival route should use the east leg, not the next leg. We think that the FAA should figure out some way to permit steeper descents of aircraft so they can cross populated areas at higher altitudes. We think the FAA needs to disperse flights, and we challenge the concept that vectoring is the same thing as dispersion. And we want vortex generators on old Airbus aircraft. Further, we think the process is fundamentally flawed, as is my remote control. The idea that solutions would be proposed by non-professionals just doesn't make sense. There are certainly brilliant engineers that work for the FAA. Why not let them come up with fabulous solutions that we mere mortals would overlook? We're also disappointed that the FAA will dismiss a proposed solution based on a single tiny defect. This is the FAA process, and I know that they've done this in the past, but it's the wrong process to propose a solution with 25 components and have that solution be dismissed as infeasible because one of the 25 is wrong is not a good process. We're also disappointed that there's no plan for a rigorous simulation of noise in the future, and that there's no commitment for continuing progress. We asked the Select Committee to ensure that the Select Committee help Congress define a congressionally mandated organization that can work with the communities on an ongoing basis after this Select Committee is retired.
Finally,
we do not object per se to the change from the route, which is Surfer to Big Sur, but we observe that the people who live in the green shaded area who were previously or who are currently under the Surfer noise shadow and who will not be under the Surfer noise shadow in the Big Sur case, are very likely to support this procedure and no one else.
Thank you very much. I did not ask how many of you are associated. I'm going to ask you about support in a moment, but how many of you are consider yourself members of or associated with Quiet Skies Los Altos Hills? I know we're a little geographically remote. That being said, how many of you were fundamentally sympathetic to the points that were made by the preceding speaker? Okay. Thank you very much. That takes us to Save Our Skies Monterey County. We want to welcome you. I understand you have no visual presentation. Is that correct?
Only myself.
Only yourself. All right. Well, let me just say you're looking very good. All right. So we'd ask you to introduce yourself, take 7 minutes, and you've got a timekeeper over here who'll flash that yellow card when 30 seconds are left. And thank you to our preceding speaker from Quiet Skies Los Altos Hills for being here.
Thank you very much for allowing me to be here. My name is Rich Cheatham. I'm from Monterey County. I reside in Carmel Valley. And I want to tell you a little bit about how our organization, Save Our Skies Monterey County, came into existence. Basically, it is a result of the hard work that was done by Save Our Skies Santa Cruz County. We were not hit with the noise that was battering this area until shortly after Labor Day 2015. We couldn't figure out what was going on. We had moved there, like so many other people, to a spot that was very desirable, very quiet. And all of a sudden, we find out we have a superhighway of airplanes running over our head. We found out from the folks here at Save Our Skies Santa Cruz what was going on. We found also that our house in Carmel Valley was located right beneath the Gnarly Point, the convergence point of all the planes coming up from the LA area, San Diego, and from coming southeast from as far as Houston, Phoenix. They were all coming in and getting into the Surfer One line and then going in to San Francisco Airport. We live 80 nautical miles away from that. The reason I raise this issue
is because we're not simply talking about the decisions being made here or in the future will impact not simply your areas, but also it has a much wider impact as well. And I'm talking about Monterey County as well. We have a tremendous amount of noise where we are, and it's all caused by flights on Surfer One going in to San Francisco Airport. We didn't have these problems before because, of course, we were on the Big Sur 2 setup, very much so. What I'm here to do is to encourage the committee to not only listen to the complaints and the suggestions of these very fine and talented people who are involved in this, very committed folks involved in Save Our Skies Santa Cruz, but to also listen to them in your deliberations. Use their input. Don't just take it and walk away. Get them involved. You want to avoid the problem of groupthink, where you're all operating off the same assumptions and none of these are challenged. You need people there who are very talented, and you've already seen several of them tonight, who can give you a great deal of very helpful input. And so I would urge you to use that talent in making these decisions. Don't just take their suggestions and their complaints and leave it at that. So that's what is why I want to leave you. I'm not simply being altruistic about our friends up here in Santa Cruz. This is our rear ends involved as well. So I ask you to, again, include them in your decisions. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And how many of you are affiliated with Save Our Skies Monterey County? I know most of the crowd is from Santa Cruz County, okay. And how many of you are fundamentally sympathetic to the point of view you just heard? All right, thank you very much. That brings us to our fourth and final community noise group for the evening. That is the San Lorenzo Valley Advocacy Group. And before the gentleman begins his remarks, I was remiss in mentioning we will find a way to get the slides that we saw earlier and make them available to the general public. Are they up on a website already from Quiet Skies Los Altos Hills? Yes, no, maybe? Somebody? Bill? But to be posted, yet? All right, so they'll be shared. Thank you. Thank you very much. Welcome, and you're our fourth and final visitor.
Thank you, everyone. My name is George Wiley. I'm a retired Navy pilot and United Airlines captain with 35 years experience. I've flown the big arrival countless times, and I'm also a San Lorenzo Valley resident and serve as a elected trustee for the San Lorenzo Valley Board of Education. And I'm going to give over the mic to my Jackie Rice here in a minute. Thank you for the opportunity to present perspectives from all parts of Santa Cruz County. Many of us are new to the table here and are grateful for the opportunity to provide meaningful input to this committee for the first time. I'd like to direct your attention to page 11 of the FAA initiative document, wherein the Quiet Skies NorCal Advocacy Group proposes that the Surfer arrival ground track be moved back to the Big Sur track and that the Big Sur flight track altitudes then be adjusted in order to allow for optimum profile descents. The suggestion has been assessed by the FAA, quote, the FAA as, quote, feasible. It should be noted that Quiet Skies, in making their proposal, failed to adequately seek input from the very stakeholders who would be most affected by this proposed flight path change, those who live under or near the Big Sur flight path. It should be noted that Quiet Skies, the failure to include these essential stakeholders during the formative stages of this proposal deprived entire communities of the opportunity to provide vital input to this discussion. When a small number of us became aware, we met with Quiet Skies organizers to provide input, but our ideas were rejected and no consensus was reached. The result is that this proposal erroneously concludes that the solution for the surfer noise problem is to move the flight path. All this would do is move the noise elsewhere. Put simply, the notion that moving the arrival from Surfer to Big Sur will reduce aircraft noise is patently false. According to this document, again the FAA initiative, the optimum profile descent parameters would be applied to Big Sur in the same manner as they were for Surfer, resulting in lower overflight altitudes along the Big Sur track. The noise intensity under Big Sur would then be exactly equal to what currently exists under Surfer. Can you imagine the outcry from the Santa Cruz downtown and west side, Pasatiempo, Mount Hermon, the Santa Rosa Valley, Bonnie Doon, and Scotts Valley residents when they are impacted by this new, lower, louder, and more concentrated flight path. Fortunately, our elected officials had the foresight to impose the following guiding principles. Last June, the Santa Cruz County Board of Supervisors instructed Supervisors Leopold and McPherson, and thank you, Bruce, for mentioning this, who were primarily members of the select committee, to, quote, discuss only remedies that do not impact other Santa Cruz County residents. The currently published SFO Airport Community Roundtable Strategic Plan directs that, quote, the roundtable members, as a group, when considering and taking actions to mitigate noise, will not knowingly, deliberately, or deliberately support, encourage, or adopt actions, rules, regulations, or policies that result in the shifting of aircraft noise from one community to another. And finally, Congresswoman Anna Eshoo made absolutely clear during her announcement during the creation of this very select committee that, quote, this is a regional problem that calls for a regional solution. Simply shifting noise from one community to another is not an option. Please consider. Please consider, a sizable and growing group of community members do not agree with the proposed movement of the surfer flight path back to Big Sur. Therefore, this proposal does not constitute an authentic regional solution to this problem. A much larger group of now silent and as yet unaware community members will become exceedingly vocal if this flight path change is considered. We therefore ask this select committee to follow the guiding principles set forth during the committee's creation and reject the proposal to move Surfer to Big Sur and instead seek other more viable regional solutions such as the use of altitude changes that do not shift the noise problem from one community to another. And finally, we greatly appreciate the committee's hard work and fairness in trying to find a workable solution to this challenge among multiple conflicting opinions offered. Thank you for your considerable time and effort to address this difficult issue. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was the San Lorenzo Valley Advocacy Group, and they
Part two. Good evening, my name is Jackie Rice, and I am a community member that lives in the San Lorenzo Valley. I have been closely following any newspaper articles or announcements about the jet flight path change that occurred last March. The Sentinel newspaper had the first published open invitation to a Save Our Skies Santa Cruz meeting on May 18th for meeting the next evening. I came to this meeting with our neighboring community group, empathetic to the lower planes and noise, especially at night. I expected to hear some win-win solutions. What was shared there was a 180 different viewpoint. I witnessed Patrick Meyer, co-chairman of this committee, speak about how the FAA doesn't like to hear the term move back the jet path, so he has changed the wording, added some directional changes, and altered flight course info to trick the FAA that moving the flight path back was not his true goals. At this, the audience loudly cheered and voiced visceral verbal approval responses to this. For example, stick it back to them, let them deal with this, dump it back to them. An FAA document was presented with a number of complaints and the number of callers for January. News articles have listed over 100,000 complaints in 2015. This is why Scotts Valley had 23,239 complaints from 110 callers. Simple math can tell us how these yearly complaint numbers are so high. After the meeting, I asked Ben Sheliff about the absence of shared information to the future affected flight path residents. He assured me that returning the flight path back to the old path would not affect SLV. We looked at a map, and he had determined that SLV was only a narrow corridor of homes along Highway 9. So now, and by their zip code city correlations, Felton, Ben Lomond, Mount Hermon, Henry Cal Park, Lompico, Brookdale, Boulder Creek are not in the San Lorenzo Valley. And these communities are not living under these groups' proposed changes. I thought our county residents stood up for each other to make sure that everybody that will be affected by big community decisions are publicly made aware of these decisions and not by Facebook and website announcements. We have a huge unsuspecting swath of residents. I'm sorry, recording because of him. not counting, it's SLV alone, not counting Westside, Santa Cruz, Paso Tiempo, Bonny Doon, that will come forth with a roar to public officials over the fact that the primary goal and impact of this group was decided without any voices heard but their own. This is not community consent or regional approval, as required by the FAA and select community members, and also certainly not how two neighboring communities interact with each other. Thank you.
Okay. So let me ask, how many of you here are associated with the San Lorenzo Valley Advocacy Group? Show of hands. All right. And how many of you share the views more or less that you just heard? Show of hands. All right, starting to get interesting, isn't it? All right. Follow-up, select committee members, limited follow-up for the four community groups. I want to get to the general public comment. We have about 35, 40 cards, I believe. And if you have a card and want to speak and it hasn't been collected yet, please raise it. And a couple of you have asked, if you want to speak anonymously, you certainly may. But if you share your information with us, that allows us to know who we're hearing from, and it also allows us to keep you informed as time goes by. And meanwhile, if you can exit, those of you who are exiting, as quietly as possible, please. Committee members, are there follow-up questions for the four groups we just heard from? Please. Any questions from the committee for the four groups we just heard from? Not at this time. All right, then we're going to let folks exit who want to exit before we have comments from members of the community. We have some more cards right here in the front row to the left. All right, I'm going to begin to call you up. I'm going to call you up in groups of three, and if you can stack right up so that we can move along as quickly as possible. We're going to allow 90 seconds per speaker, and we're going to ask that our timekeeper flag you when you have 30 seconds left. And we have, I believe it's Bob Ciotti to be followed by Dave Austin to be followed by Grant Wesseman. And forgive me, some of you have handwriting that matches my own. So, Bob Ciotti to be followed by Dave Austin to be followed by Grant Wesseman. Please come up to the microphone. And take about a minute and a half. And please try and address your comments to the select committee. And if, are you Mr. Ciotti?
Yes, it is.
And am I pronouncing your name correctly?
Ciotti.
Ciotti, thank you.
Ciotti. You want to say it right.
Got it. All right. I'm going to let you get a quiet room before you begin so we can hear you. Welcome and thank you. Go right ahead.
So I worked on some of the proposals for SOS Santa Cruz, and I think that people are angry. What's been said, I think, is untrue in some ways, but there are some misconceptions about what we want. The vertical profile of Surfer is much narrower and lower than Big Sur. And so we know that there were very vast differences in sound levels between Big Sur and Surfer, but we don't really know why. I don't know if it's really that it's lower. It's faster, it's more narrow, and it is lower too. When the FAA talks about the approach glide scope for OPD, they've said it's about 2.8 to 2.7 degrees. And so we think Big Sur was flown at about 3. And so is that enough to account for the noise difference or not? We don't know. But what we really want from the select committee and the FAA is to produce a procedure that is quieter than Big Sur was. And I think that that can be done, and we have some additional suggestions on how to do that. Maybe that's a level segment out in the bay to slow aircraft down. Maybe it's getting it a little bit higher up so the planes can float in. Certainly, there's not a good understanding of exactly why it's so much louder, and is that OPD? If you're flying faster, there may be, some use of high lift components on the aircraft that create more drag and noise. So Anyway, that's what we want. We want it to be as good as it was.
All right, thank you. And again, folks, I'm going to ask you to hold your applause because otherwise we'll be here all night long. I want to go directly to Dave Austin, followed by Grant Wesseman, followed by, I believe it's Tammy Mulcahy. Welcome.
Now, my name is Dave Austin. I'm with Save Our Skies. I, like George, am a Navy pilot, former Navy pilot, and I was a PSA pilot hired back in 1976, so I do have some perspective. I was actually at PSA when the Big Sur arrival was designed and flown at that time. It was only by aircraft that had inertial navigation systems. PSA aircraft did not. So I didn't participate in it. But I've got a study that's called Aircraft Noise, a Toolkit for Managing Community Expectations. And this was written for the FAA by a group in Kansas. And it talks about the design of the Big Sur arrival and why it was so successful and why there were no complaints. I mean, zero, maybe one complaint a year. It was high over the coast coming inbound. After it passed over basically the west end of Scotts Valley, it was over non-populated areas, and once it got into the Stanford area, it was over an industrial park. So I have a copy of each one of you to give you, and it's just 3 pages out of 100 or so that you can all examine and apply as you wish. And I'll leave these with you.
Thank you very much. If you hand it to my staff, she'll hand it out. Grant Wesseman to be followed by Tammy Mulcahy, and then I believe it's Brett, forgive me, Grassley.
Welcome. Hi, I'm Grant Wesseman. I just wanted to start off by saying that for 30 years, from 79 to 09, I was a firefighter here in the city of Santa Cruz. And during that time, I lived between the place next door, a place on the west side, and another one on the east side. Imagine my surprise that after all that time, when in March of last year, I found out I was under a flight path, that apparently I had been under a flight path for the previous 30 years. This is like astounding. Nobody ever talked about it. I never read any stories about it. It was a complete mystery to me, like how this remained a secret for all those years. But I also want to, at this point, and take that as a remark on the intensity of the impact prior to last year in March. But I also want to say that in reference to the rule that they talked about not moving noise, I find it really interesting that you cannot, that you can go ahead and move noise even though there's a rule against it, but when it comes time to move it back, then you will cite that rule as not being fair.
Thank you very much. Tammy Mulcahy, followed by Brett Gressley, followed by Marilyn Garrett, and I believe it's Marilyn. And before you begin, Ms. Mulcahy, I'm noticing a shocked look on the face of our speakers when that yellow card goes up, telling them that they've used up 60 of their 90 seconds. So I want to encourage you again. If you've got a point that you want to make sure these 12 people remember when they walk out the door, hit us with it as soon as you hit that microphone. Tell us what it is you want us to know, because that 90 seconds can go pretty quickly. So, welcome. None of that was your time, by the way. Not to worry. And Ms. Mulcahy, welcome and thank you for being with us.
Hi, I first want to say that a comment that modernization is meant to improve lives, and of course this clearly has not. I want to echo what our friend in Los Altos Hills said, that I wonder how many great ideas are missed if the FAA would go back and use its own ingenuity and not leave it to lay people to give them palpable solutions. I think if they went back and redesigned the airspace with noise as a priority, what would they have done different to meet that criteria? I also fundamentally object to sacrificial noise corridors, and I find that a morally corrupt concept. Whether you go up Big Sur or you go up Surfer, it's a morally corrupt concept to jam everything into one small corridor. And finally, I live at the pinnacle where Surfer and Big Sur come together in North Los Altos, so it doesn't really make much difference to me. You're going to shove it into the corridor one way or the other. But I've got planes coming from the east, the north, the west, from Frankfurt, Copenhagen, China, India, and they're coming in around 4,000 feet, give or take. Noise needs to be dispersed, and you can't circle it all into the same area. So that is what I have to say. And you add San Jose Airport occasionally having a flight take off, and you have Surf Air. They're all up in there in that small airspace. There's no way on earth this is more safe.
Thank you very much. Brett Presley, followed by Marilyn Garrett, followed by Gary Green. Welcome.
Hi. I can't imagine what sadistic mind named a plane route Surfer that destroyed the peace and quiet of a town called Capitola. Currently, the regulations call for a major drop of altitude 5,000 feet off the Capitola wharf. The planes roar over the jewel box and head straight to the mountain. I've reported 3 times in the last 2 days flights flying at 7,000 feet going over. I'm sorry for the mountain people that are at a lot lower than that. I've lived there 20 years. I've never had any problems with any noise at night. They fly constantly. I mean, even down in Newport in Balboa Island, they at least have windows of time. 7 a.m., the jets roar over. They shut down from midnight onward. I'd like to have you guys take that into consideration, hours of operation. Please repeal this flight path immediately. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your comments. I believe it's Marilyn Garrett to be followed by Gary Green and then Bill Miller. Welcome.
It's noise, it's fuel contamination, and it's radiation contamination from the transponders on the plane. A friend of mine moved remotely to the Santa Cruz Mountains. The flight path is over her now. She moved because she nearly died from smart meter radiation. She's far from PG&E smart meters, but it's under this flight path. She has a full spectrum analyzer that detects the radiation. Every time the plane goes over, it goes up. And there's a sound to it also. I have a detector of radiation just from in here from all the wireless microwave technology. She is extremely ill from this and also from the new radar weather stuff. I was asking a friend, why did they change the flight pattern? And she read somewhere, I guess in the reasons of the FAA, it was to make more airspace for drones and military flights. And I wonder where I can get the verification of that. And in case anyone doesn't know, drones are microwave radiation weaponry. Why did they change this? Is that why? Because of drones and military flight space wanted? Thank you.
Thank you. Gary Green to be followed by Bill Miller and Jim Mosher. Mr. Green?
I'm Gary Green. I'm a Marine geophysicist. I use noise, I use sound to investigate the marine environment.
And could you pull that microphone up to use sound a little more efficiently? Thank you.
Okay, sorry about that. I use sound to investigate the marine environment. I have to use sound under very difficult regulations. I have to be able to measure that sound. I have to be able to tell whether the sound is interfering with other organisms within the ocean. I was a bad boy at one time, used dynamite in the ocean. I no longer do that, and I believe in the regulations, and I think that we should use sound properly in the marine environment. I also think that we need to use sounds properly in our environment here, and it's pretty clear to me that there's a disconnect between the FAA and the airline, favoring the airlines and not favoring the people on the ground. So I think noise can be measured, and it should be considered. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Bill Miller to be followed by Jim Mosher to be followed by Robin Mara. Welcome.
Hello.
The FAA states that the path has changed to the new Surfer One path, and they would require quite a bit of work and study to move it back or to another flight path. And I live under the flight path, and some days they move the planes to a different flight path without any new regulations, any new studies, and they've been moved like for, you know, 24-hour periods to a completely different path, non-weather related. So it is possible now to move these planes to a different location without any changes. And I would like to hear a rebuttal if I'm incorrect.
Thank you for your comments. That takes us to Jim Mosher to be followed by Robin Mara to be followed by Roger Welsh. Welcome.
Yes, thank you for the opportunity to speak. I'm Jim Mosher. I live in the San Lorenzo Valley. And I just want to reemphasize what George Wiley said, the importance of a regional solution here and not simply moving the problem from one area to another. The original flight plan did not affect San Lorenzo Valley, but if we move it back at the lower altitudes, we're going to have the same problems. It seems to me this is a noise issue and an altitude issue, and it's a matter of putting communities first and not the airline's efficiency first. This is critical. And so I really commend this committee representing all of the communities that can be affected, and I urge you to come to a regional solution that does not simply move the problem around. Thank you.
Thank you. That brings us to Robin Mara to be followed by Roger Welsh and Tom Mitchell. Welcome.
Thank you for your time. I don't want to reiterate all the things. We know everybody's here because they're upset, primarily about noise. I wanted to bring up to your awareness that noise is just the sound, right? But what it's really doing is it's impacting the health of our community, because I bet everybody in this room in the Santa Cruz County was woken up multiple times. You can't go to sleep at night, and you're woken up between 5 and 6 in the morning. It's a long-term health problem that needs to be addressed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Roger Welsh to be followed by Tom Mitchell and Tim Delaney. Welcome.
Thank you very much. It's a privilege to be here, and I want to thank the Select Committee and the FAA for allowing this process to happen. I'm just amazed by it, and I think we're going to get a very positive result at the end of the day, hopefully for as many people as possible. I live in Aptos, right by Cabrillo College. I used to see the old route, and I couldn't hear the planes at all. I could see them, but I couldn't hear them. The new flight path, I feel like I'm in a bomber zone, 24/7. The difference is quality of life. It's huge, absolutely huge. It's unbelievably very, very disturbing. My one question I would hope that the Select Committee might ask the FAA would be, from my understanding, they're designing new engines that are 75% quieter. And is there any plans to mandate the airline industry to start implementing these quieter engines? Would be a question that might be asked. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Tom Mitchell, Tim Delaney, Janet Molesky.
Thank you. My name is Tom Mitchell. I've lived here all my life. I've lived in my house for 34 years. Bruce McPherson used to be my neighbor.
Was he a good neighbor?
He's a good neighbor.
All right.
He's a good man. And he's a good family. But what we're talking about here today is we're talking about what's fair. You know, it's not about the noise. The noise problem is not going to be solved by us today. It's going to be solved hopefully someday by technology. But what's fair? What was fair before March 5th of last year? I'm living in my house now after 34 years and having to listen to the jets go by every 5 minutes. And I'm retired now. I want to spend time with the trees and the birds and my animals. This is crazy. We aren't going to be able to solve the problems that people have had since 2011 up in the Los Altos Hills. But we can change it back to the Big Sur. And that's what you guys should be doing. Change it back to the Big Sur. Let's start from there. And the rest of the problems have to be taken up with the FAA. But we want the Big Sur back before March 5th, one complaint versus hundreds of thousands. Thank you.
Thank you. Tim Delaney, please. Tim Delaney, followed by Janet Molesky and Kevin Flynn.
Hi, I'm Tim Delaney. I'm a retired Lockheed Martin space systems engineer. And one thing I don't buy when it comes to the FAA, you know, I hear all this difficulty moving the planes around and flight paths and all this sort of stuff. Anything can be solved. If I can build the computer systems for Lockheed Martin so we can have our latest space telescope out there finding planets and, you know, we end up on Mars and whatnot, you know, you can tell I'm not a very good public speaker here because I'm the introvert in the lab building these systems. If we can do that, we can do anything. And what I want to point out to the FAA here is when I first noticed these planes coming over my house at the top of Summit, these planes initially came in below the level of my deck. And they're climbing and getting over the top of my trees that are filled with vultures and hawks. And nearby down the road, we have a public school system filled with 500 to 700 other people's kids. So all this lacks common sense. Why can't the FAA have their planes at a higher level and merge into the north-southbound flight path to SFO and then peel off to the San Jose airport and circle and come in for their landing? So that would be a much safer way of doing things, I think. Certainly, you know, I could see that I'm trapped with business interests here. We have, you know, international business. We have the FAA, and we have domestic flights and all that sort of stuff. So, you know, I'm a little concerned here. Anyways, I'm done now, and thank you very much. And
thank you very much. Janet Molesky to be followed by Kevin Flynn and Mary Salas. Ms. Molesky.
Hello. Thank you for your time working on this, and I hope you can stay long enough to see this through. I live on Summit West, which is up on Highway 17 and the Summit area. We've been bombarded with not just arrivals into SFO, but also departures, which are coming over us around 20,000 foot elevation, and they are amazingly loud. It is unfathomable to me how they could be so loud at that altitude. The other issue that we're faced with on the Summit is the BRICS crossover, which is taking planes below sometimes 5,000 feet over the Summit. And this feels like an attack. I bought my property 13 years ago for serenity and peace. I have a lot of hardship. We had two power outages in the last week. We lose trees. I spend thousands of dollars every year to clear the tree path where the road is so that it's safe. And they fall down and we still have to maintain them. It's hard. In terms of the quality of life, I just want to say that we need to lay a foundation that includes the noise and noise abatement, and that's for the FAA.
Thank you very much. All right. We're going to go with Kevin Flynn, Mary Salas, and Melinda McComb. And if you see me doing that does not mean wahoo. That means please wrap it up if you can, please. Okay? Thank you very much.
My name is Kevin Flynn. I'm a resident of Santa Cruz Mountains. I also happen to be the vice president of the board of directors for the Semper Virens Fund, which has been protecting redwood forests here in the mountains for 116 years. A very quick question for the FAA. Looking at the crowd here, would you say there may be a significant impact on the citizens of this area?
Mr. Flynn, I'm gonna just ask you your comments to the Select Committee.
Maybe I'll ask the question of you guys the FAA at a later date. It's a very simple question. May there be a significant impact on the citizens of this area? It's a yes or no question of the FAA. It has very important ramifications, and I can explain some of those offline if you'd like. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mary Salas, Melinda McComb, and Chris Kapp. Welcome.
Hello, I'm Mary Talpas. I just want to say that this is a health issue. I live at the bottom of Fairway in Soquel, and my windows vibrate when the planes put on their air brakes. And it's every 5 minutes. And this is something that needs to be changed immediately and go back to the other flight path. There wasn't a lot of complaints. Fix it now and then find a long-term solution.
Thank you. Melinda McComb, Chris Kapp, and Catherine B.
Melinda McComb, Soquel. I would like to reiterate about the health concerns. Noise is a stressor. I find it completely robs me of quiet enjoyment in my outdoor areas and my indoor areas. It's not consistent. Some days it's so loud that I can't be outdoors. But I'm also concerned about the pollution from the planes. I'm concerned about, of course, the noise, but also the radar from the planes. You are 100% in the radar of all of those planes, and it's beaming down on you while they are flying over you within a certain distance. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Chris Kapp, Catherine B., and then Joseph, I believe it's Oles. Chris Kapp, welcome.
Hello. It seemed I only got a half an hour. I could go for a while. See, I'm a longtime resident. My grandfather was a blacksmith at a factory up there. He used to cast gears. Basically, what I got to say is, to begin with, the question I wanted to ask is they didn't file an environmental impact report when they started this whole thing. They just kind of sort of threw it at everybody. Leastwise, that's what I
understand. Mr. Kapp, can I ask you to stop for just a minute, please? Hang on a second. Thank you. Go right ahead.
Okay, and then, unless I'm mistaken, Supreme Court has stated many times that I have the right to quiet enjoyment of my property. Okay, now, listen, that's a law of the land, and this is a law. This is a land of laws, and if the only way I could see this could possibly have happened if we live like a dictator was at, and he would decree it, we're taking your property rights away. And that's my basic point. It's all about money and greed.
Thank you for your comments. Catherine B., to be followed by Joseph Oles, to be followed by Marie Jo Fremont. Catherine B.? We do have written comments from Catherine B., and we'll record them in the record. Joseph Oles, to be followed by Marie Jo Fremont and Mary Talpar.
Hi, two basic points. I'm near the summit in 17. Aerospace engineer myself from NASA and an aerospace company. It's so much worse. It's horrible. I used to look at the aircraft as a neat little thing way, way up in the sky. It was kind of fun to see them at times. It's horrible now. One airplane at a time, two airplanes at a time, three loud airplanes at a time. It doesn't end. It's worse than a landing zone all the time. Two jets, one small plane, they're all over all the time. They seem to get lower at night. After midnight, 3 in the morning, 5 in the morning, take a look at the altitudes. I hit that stupid little button so many times to complain about these things. It's driving me up the wall. I love my house. I love the area. It's driving me crazy. I don't know if I have to leave or what. This is horrible. Second point, the disingenuity, I think, of the FAA, in general, the immorality as I see it, waiting 6 months so that no one can have a lawsuit against this, trying to push this down our throats. The executive over in Oakland, not an FAA guy, making the jokes, making fun of residents who are having a horrible time. Sadistic behavior. It's sick. This is when the government's executives are run amok. Please do something. Going forward right now, it seems to be the same bad faith. They talk about efficiency, 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 the optimal glide path. There's one for efficiency, there's a second one for noise. You need to trade those off. Please realize there's two of them. To answer the former gentleman's question, what he didn't really answer, yes, in the very final glide path, you need to have a certain altitude to be safe. Well away from that, you can be way higher. It's safer and less noisy. Please take our noise issues into account. It's driving us crazy, please.
Thank you for your comments. Could we hear from Marie Jo Fremont, Mary Talpar, Daniel Friedman? Welcome.
So, thank you. I want to support all the citizens who have come today because we're all in the same boat. But I want to speak from my perspective, a Palo Alto resident. So, what am I doing here? Well, there's a reason. As you know, Palo Alto is called the perfect storm by the San Francisco Noise Abatement Office. The reason is because we get the three arrival routes from the north, from the west, from the south. And we are close to that final waypoint, the Menlo waypoint, which is the one, the last one for the fine tuning before the final approach. So let me tell you my personal story. I have the privilege of having reported personally 6,000 planes through stopjetnoise.net over 6 months. It was winter. Two-thirds were between 8 and 9 p.m. One-third was between 9 p.m. and 8 a.m. That's 20% between 9 p.m. and 11 p.m. I got 4% between 11 p.m. and 6 a.m. It was winter, my windows were closed. And I'm really bad when I'm trying to sleep to be clicking on a phone. So my point is, Palo Alto is ground zero. If you fix ground zero, you will fix all the problems from everybody else because we're on the last pass to the airport right now. So think bigger, think about the Metroplex, think about all these cities, not because I'm from Palo Alto. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And forgive me, I think it's Mary Talpas, not Mary.
I spoke already.
You spoke earlier? All right, thank you. We have your written comments, though, as well. Thank you. Daniel Friedman, Rick Parfit, and Ryan Martin. How about Daniel Friedman? May have left, all right. Rick Parfit? We lost. There's Rick, thank you. Welcome. Followed by Ryan Martin.
So I have just three things I want to say, and they're all related. And the first one is I really want to thank the Select Committee. I want to thank the Special Neighborhoods and all the people that are here for making this look for good solutions. And secondly, these are complex issues. A Class B space, optimized OPD, bricks, surfer, vectoring versus dispersion. I don't pretend to understand it all. I was at the meeting last week in Scotts Valley where I got a debriefing. These are deeply technical issues, and I really, really appreciate the members of our community that have put together the proposals of the FAA, the people that have put up the noise monitoring, the people that have been tracking the flights. And my final point is, going back in time, there was a Supreme Court justice that said, I can't define pornography, but I know it when I see it. I can't define the noise problem, but I'll know when I don't hear it. And we're going to be here until this problem's solved. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much. Ryan Martin, Donald Wright, Eric Rupp, and Terry Williams. Ryan Martin still with us? No. How about Donald Wright? Thank you, Mr. Wright. To be followed by Eric Rupp and Terry Williams.
Evening. I'm standing here before you as perhaps the newest U.S. citizen in this building tonight. Yesterday, after many years of living here as a permanent resident from Canada, I took the oath of citizenship. Thank you. I bring this up not for applause, but because I would not have made this commitment if I thought that government here couldn't be responsive to the needs of the people. Nevertheless, I'm aware that for years there has been a growing loss of faith in our public institutions in this country. But you, the elected representatives of the Select Committee, have the opportunity to help reverse this alarming trend by fixing the FAA errors by supporting the regional solution put forward by Quiet Skies NorCal. This includes, among other things, moving the SFO arrivals back to where it was before March 2015, when all the problems for so much of our county began. And you can then make that route even better by endorsing the sensible solutions about raising the altitude, slowing speeds that create an optimal profile descent, as mentioned by Glenn Martin. Being in charge means making tough choices. But in this case, you don't have a tough choice to make at all. We have over 30 years of experience showing that the old Big Sur arrivals route worked well with minimal noise problems, and the FAA is now on record as saying that moving these arrivals track back to Big Sur is feasible. It is simply not credible that restoring the Big Sur route at higher altitudes using optimal power descent will be noisy like it now is under Surfer. So please don't squander this chance you have in your hands to quickly do the most good for the most people, which is what government's all about. The choice is clear. Endorse the NorCal regional solution, and you'll earn the vote of this newly minted citizen, along with, I'm sure, those of the majority here in Santa Cruz County.
Thank you very much. Eric Rupp, to be followed by Terry Williams, to be followed by, I believe it's Lauren Githens. Eric Rupp.
Good evening. Fundamentally, it is not true that the solutions need to be a zero-sum game. It is not true that the solutions that are good for one group need to be bad for another group. The reason that's the case here is the opportunity created by the Surfer arrival. Very sloppily designed, rush job. In fact, it's so bad that even people underneath the old Big Sur are bothered by it. Now the Select Committee must focus. And we believe that the regional solutions that you all have provided by Quiet Skies NorCal provide that focus. They're a good blueprint for finding solutions that can be better for everybody and better than ever. I'll conclude by just saying that the Big Sur arrival was an arrival that this community has lived comfortably with for the last 30 plus years. It simply worked. And our proposal is a way to make it higher, slower, and quieter, and in a few words, better for everybody and better than ever. Thank you.
Thank you. Terry Williams, to be followed by Lauren Githens, to be followed by Bill Spence. And if we could ask you to come on down and line up just to save a little time for everybody. So it's Terry Williams, Lauren Githens, Bill Spence, and then it's going to be Denise Stansfield and Alistair Fife. Terry not here? How about Lauren Githens?
Okay, what I'd like to say, most people have already said already, but what I would just like to reiterate is that nobody here wants to move Surfer in its current form on other people. We need to be very clear about that. What we want moved, we want it returned to its former route, because it's simply not fair to leave it over people that moved into areas and built their lives in areas that were not under flight paths when they moved there. That's all I have to say. Thank you very much for serving on this committee.
Thank you. Bill Spence, Denise Stansfield, Alistair Fife, Celeste Githens, and Robert Bowman. Welcome. Thank you.
Hi, guys. My name is Bill Spence. I live in La Silva, and thanks for taking the time to listen to us. I'm here to represent the South County of Santa Cruz. Watsonville, La Silva, Aptos, over 100,000 people. A lot of attention has been put on Surfer, but I want to make sure that attention is also given to the impact of the SFO Oakland South arrivals that go down the spine of the Santa Cruz Mountains. Essentially, between Surfer on the incoming side and these departures on the outgoing side, and if you throw in, believe it or not, a route that goes from LAX to Asia that goes inbound and outbound, Little South County is stuck in the middle. We get them incoming at 15,000 feet. We get them outgoing at 20,000 feet and full throttle. And then we get another set at 30,000 feet flying over us as well. So just to give you an idea, and I apologize for the resolution because it was such a tiny spot on my screen. This is South County at 3:08 today. Five planes all traveling over our little environment. So, guys, all I ask is please don't forget South County. Please make sure to mitigate the noise from the SFO Oakland Southern departures and move them out over the bay. Please move Surfer back to where
Thank
it was.
Thank you for your comments.
We used to hear comments. Waves. Thank you for your comments.
Denise Stansfield, Alistair Fife, Celeste Githens, Robert Bowman, and I believe it's Renee Vota, Vera, Vepa. Thank you. Ms. Stansfield?
Yes.
Welcome.
Hi, my name is Denise Stansfield, founder of Save Our Skies, Santa Cruz County. Our Save Our Skies community represents thousands of dedicated supporters that span from Capitola across the Santa Cruz Mountains all the way to Saratoga. Our strength is in numbers, and united we stand. Our petition to rescind Surfer has over 4,500 signatures. Our Facebook has over 3,000 followers, reaching at times over 2,500 hits at any given post. Our website has over 88,000 hits since its launch in June, and our newsletter e-blasts reach well over 600 dedicated readers on a weekly basis. Some said our movement couldn't make a difference, that the FAA was too big a giant, a government agency cloaked in bureaucracy. I am proud to be standing here tonight witnessing the results of our faith in democracy. We hold on to the values that the supreme power is vested in the people, and we are willing to stand up for what is right. We, the people, want to thank Sam Farr, Anna Eshoo, and Spear for sending our message all the way to Washington, creating a system of representation through the Select Committee, and for serving the people, not the corporations. Thank you.
Thank you. Alistair Fife, Celeste Githens, Robert Bowman, Renee, Raymond Gwinden. In that order, please. Welcome.
Welcome. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman Sumishian, for reminding us to use topic sentences. Mine is that solutions that spread arrival traffic as widely as possible over the county improve the situation for all and will gain the widest support. Moving a concentrated stream of traffic simply changes those who is affected, I appreciate you all taking the time to listen to us complain today, but I think it's a fairly safe bet. You don't want to be here next year listening to a different set of people complaining for pretty much the same reasons. No one knows what the impact of the adjusted flight changes will be over Big Sur, but we know that the measurement devices available to us, as pointed out by Mr. Waldeck and Mr. Martin, are inaccurate. We know that the reporting of noise impact SFO is inaccurate, as reported by Jackie Rice. We don't have any way of assessing that. We do have some data, if you, particularly for Santa Cruz County. If you focus on the figures in Appendix E of the feasibility report, you will basically see what the distribution of noise under the flight backs was in 2014 and what it is now. Surfer actually has a wider distribution, but clearly from all the people here, you've heard that the concentration is now excessive over parts of the county. I would urge you all to consider plans that use both the Surfer and Big Sur ground tracks and find a way to distribute traffic between them. Thank you.
Thank you. Celeste Githens, Robert Bowman, then Renee, then Raymond. Welcome.
Thank you. Hi. I'm a seventh grade math teacher. It's a job that requires high energy, cool composure, and a keen sense of humor. But I've been working under a unique set of challenges this year, trying to muster those qualities while suffering from sleep deprivation, anxiety, and related health challenges. I'd like to apologize to those of you on the Select Committee who I may have written to at 2 a.m, begging you for relief, because I know I may not have been at my most polite. But there is a certain sense of desperation when you know there is nowhere you can turn for help. When you've told me that county noise ordinances don't apply to the FAA. So I'm here to put myself out there and share some really significant impacts on me. I've lost 15% of my body weight in the last year, and that's very troubling as the numbers continue to drop every single month. I have an irregular heartbeat that keeps me up at night as my heart is racing while I'm trying to fall asleep under the stress of this constant noise. What has happened to me should not have happened, and it shouldn't happen to anyone else. And
we don't want it simply moved to another part of the county. If the FAA wants to optimize the Metroplex, they need to do it in a way that won't pit members of our community against each other.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Robert Bowman, followed by Renee, followed by Raymond, followed by Christopher, followed by Mark Joyner.
Thank you, committee. I just want to point out a very obvious but not brought up problem. The FAA used a flat geographical map. We're a mountainous community. They did not take into consideration the topography. When you live in a ravine or you live in a valley, it's like living in an amphitheater. The sound becomes amplified. Most of us here, probably the most stalwart members here, are probably up in the mountains because we experience it the most. And I truly do not think that the FAA took mountains, an obvious thing, into consideration when they did their planning. And I hope they do in the future.
Thank you very much. Renee, Ramon, Quinden, then Christopher Lamb, then Mark Joyner. Welcome.
Hi, I'm Renee Vega. I have a system called the Citizens Noise Monitoring System, and it records all of the noise that happens around my area and about 12 other monitors. That includes all of the ridge areas on the summit, that includes along the surfer track. There's a couple in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and there's a couple in Seattle. I say that because this problem is more than just local, this is a national one. When the FAA says that it's too hard to do noise and all that, they're just simply lying. And what I want to ask you is to really push on them to make sure that they use the noise metrics whenever they make any of the plan changes. Now, there are some very good plan changes here, like there's a return to surfer. That's an immediate request. That's like an emergency request to bring us back to the reset of NextGen. The next plan is to go beyond that so that we can do a more longer-term regional approach. And so my question to you, or actually my ask of you, is to make sure that you don't get kicked out after 10 weeks like the FAA would like you to do. Stick to it, please. My website's on the card if you want to take a look at that. I lived in Mountain View near Moffitt. That was an interesting experience, and the noise was not nearly as bad as what I'm experiencing right now. There is more noise. I get over 137 to 176 over 55 dB flights over my house every single frigging day. I used to live in Ben Lomond, all along that area, and I've never experienced any kind of noise during that time, the 20 years that I was there. So think about this, and please revert back to surfer and take the long-term approach. Keep it going.
Thank you very much. All right. Let's see if we can get folks lined up. Please move a little bit more expeditiously. Raymond Gwinden, followed by Christopher Lamb, Mark Joyner, Robert McCauley, Donald Gardner, and I want to say Kelly Colburn. If we could line right up, please. Raymond Gwinden? Last call. Not here. Let's go to Christopher Lamb then.
Good evening and thank you. So I live in the Summit West area. I've got to say that the change was absolutely amazing when the new flight path went into effect. I want to particularly call out the Brix arrival change because that's a flight that comes in often 9:30, 10:30 at night and so low that I can see the logo on the plane's tail from my bedroom window as it goes by. So I definitely want you guys to keep going with this. Don't stop and keep moving forward for changes to all the different procedures that are involved here, trying to come to a regional solution. The second point I want to make is I think it's really important that you guys work with the FAA really, really hard to make sure that they have the directives and the funding to have a modern, competent way of assessing realistic noise impacts from all the myriad changes that we're proposing here, but also the ones coming down the line. And I welcome the fact that they want a community input into a solution to this immediate problem, but ultimately relying on that procedure is shirking their duty to do good engineering and coming up with solutions for our airspace. That's all. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Mark Joyner, Robert McCauley, Donald Gardner, Kelly Colburn. Mr. Joyner, welcome.
No, it's Bob McCauley.
Mr. McCauley.
Yes.
Welcome.
Well, thank you. We don't want to push our problem on anybody else. I live in the city of Santa Cruz, and it's hell. I just want the committee to stay aware and diligent in fighting the FAA. They may say they have an absolute right to make decisions with regards to this or that, but you can push a right so far it becomes an injustice, and that's what we're suffering with now. Please fix it.
Thank you very much. Second call from Mark Joyner. Thank you.
I'm a resident of Happy Valley, which is kind of a misnomer now. But from 1990 to 1995, my wife and I lived in the Seabright neighborhood on Cayuga Street. It was actually a very quiet street, well away from the ocean and boardwalk noise and such. Now, I actually had no idea at that time that I was living only 3/5 of a mile from the Big Sur flight path, really a major superhighway in the sky. And I only recall one instance of even noticing a single jet going overhead. And I heard some noise, looked up, and I thought, was that pilot lost, or what's going on here? Noise was just not a factor. Big Sur was very quiet. Now, fast forward 20 years to March 5th, 2015, which is a day that will live in infamy, just like the bombing of Pearl Harbor. When the FAA flipped the switch to the surfer flight path, the impact of the jet noise was immediate. It was unrelenting, and it was just very loud. It couldn't go unnoticed or be ignored. So clearly, jets are now emitting much higher levels of noise than they did before. Something is radically wrong with the current flight path, the current flight descent procedures. The apparent problem now is the jets are flying lower, faster, and with the engines thrusting rather than idling. The answer is not to just stick the jet path back to where it used to be. None of us suffering under the current noise barrage want to see our friends living in Santa Cruz and SLV to be subjected to the same noise that we are. No, any moving of the flight path must be accompanied by undoing the current lazy, poorly thought out flight constraints that are making possible such high levels of noise. And the move back to the historical path must result in jet overflights that are at least as quiet as they were before March 5th of last year. Nothing else should be acceptable. Thank you.
Thank you. Donald Gardner, Kelly Colburn, Teresa Ryan. Welcome.
Good evening. My name is Donald Gardner. I have one question. We were promised technical working group meetings for arrivals, and so far all I've seen is an SSO announcement for tomorrow morning for a working group meeting for arrivals and departures. And I don't know if that's the meeting or if there's going to be others, and are they going to separate arrivals from departures?
I'm not aware of a promise for a technical working group. I think there has been some discussion. Excuse me?
I saw it in several documents. That's okay. We can discuss
it. I think there has been some discussion about how we respond to technical questions or issues, given the fact that obviously this panel is not designed for that purpose. I'm going to ask you to hand a comment to my staff, and we'll follow up with you offline, though.
Okay. And my second item is something I haven't heard anyone talk about yet, and that is that dispersion was deemed unfeasible, and the reason given was because of delayed vectoring, which is about 40 or so percent of the total flights that make it over to our area. But the other thing that hasn't been said is that if we do implement time-based management, which is in the plans, that will reduce those noisy vectored airplanes, which is a good thing. But the bad thing is that it puts a lot more airplanes on the route, whether it's Surfer or Big Sur, and that's a big concern of mine. Lastly, there were several proposals that were submitted to the FAA that were not considered, from what I can tell, such as, for example, moving traffic back to the east leg of the Point Reyes route. And that, to me, is a really simple solution that would not involve moving waypoints, it would not rerouting anything, and it would not change any altitudes, and yet it would reduce a lot of airplanes from flying over the peninsula to flying over the fish in the bay. And I would really like to see that proposal addressed. And lastly, I'd like to ask the FAA to please, can you also come up with some proposals for us to look at? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Kelly Colburn, to be followed by Teresa Rind, to be followed by Kim, I believe it's Tanilla, Mark Ritson, and Barry Fitzgerald. Who among that group is still with us? And if you'd identify yourself by name and maybe pull that microphone down to a level that works for you. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name's Terry Rain. I'm living under the Surfer Path in Scotts Valley. And Surfer is not amazing. It's not innovative. It's bad. I'm mad, but I'm also really profoundly sad because I've lost my peace. It's really a hard existence right now, and as you know, it's tough. Obviously, I support moving Surfer back to Big Sur, and I come from a unique perspective. For the last 8 years, I worked in Santa Cruz, and I was directly under the Big Sur flight path. And I was shocked last week when someone told me that I was working under the Big Sur flight path because I had never heard a jet. I want to emphasize that all of our people who are in our community who could be moved, could be affected by the move back to Big Sur should be given concrete assurances that they won't have the dump of the Surfer flight path on them, and they deserve that. No one should have to live under the Surfer flight conditions like we are right now. Thank you for all you do.
Thank you. Final call for Kelly Colburn. Not here. Kim Tanilla, Mark Ritson, Barry Fitzgerald, Abby Samuels, and Ron Rohde. Please.
Hi, I'm Kim Tanilla, and since the 70s, I've worked in the field of health and nutrition, and I've performed as a nutritional researcher and writer in the past professionally, and so I delved into that aspect. And in essence, there's a major thing that needs to be looked at, and that's that this is affecting and harming the health of our community, the people, our children, the animals, the wildlife, and the environment. And in essence, I compiled a bunch of information, which really is the tip of the iceberg, and there are three major categories of impact. One is sleep deprivation, another is continuous loud intrusive jet noise, which causes stress, and another one is toxic aircraft emissions. And so I delved into the gathering all that type of data. And it's interesting because there is one website which gave a definition of sleep deprivation, for example. And it's a government agency. And that agency is called the National Institutes of Health, Department of Health and Human Services, USA government. They're also known as the NIH. Which I think should talk to the FAA, because they define sleep deprivation deficiency as sleeping is a basic human need like eating, drinking, and breathing. Like these other needs, sleeping is a vital part of the foundation for good health and well-being throughout your lifetime. Sleep deficiency can lead to physical and mental health problems, injuries, loss of productivity, and even a greater risk of death.
Thank you, Ms. Tunnell.
And I could go on, but that's all the time.
Mark Ritson, Barry Fitzgerald, Abby Samuels, Ron Rohde, and I think we've heard from Denise Stansfield, but maybe not. Welcome.
Thank you. My name is Barry Fitzgerald. I live up in the Summit area. What I'd like to do, to put a little contrast here, people talk about how much pain they have. If you don't live up in the Summit or in a quiet area, you may not appreciate the impact. So let me describe, in fact, one thing I described to Glenn at the first meeting. I was sitting out on my deck one night when there were no planes, and I could hear a lady coughing 2.5 miles away on Hutchinson Road. That is the level of quiet you're dealing with. So the only noise that you have when you live in the quiet areas of Santa Cruz County is the sound of airplanes. And it's intense and it's repetitive. Okay, so imagine, before March 5th, there were no complaints at all. After March 5th, individuals here who didn't even know each other, had no idea how to complain, suddenly start searching on the web and everything else to find out what's happened to their neighborhood and the effects that they're having. And they started finding their way to complain. They went to the SFO, San Jose, whatever. And if you take a look at the airport manager's report from SFO, you will see that there is nothing from that whole space until beginning in the March and April timeframe. So these weren't people with apps. These were people who were so upset and disturbed that they spontaneously rose up. So I just wanted to point that out.
Thank you for your comments. Mark Ritson. Thank you, sir. And then it'll be Abby Samuels.
Hi, my name is Mark Ritson. I don't envy you this job.
Please lift that mic up so we can hear your every word, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Is that better?
Much better.
Okay. So I don't envy you your job. I've spent 200 to 300 hours researching this. I live under the flight path. I'm a civil engineer. I take data seriously. I have minimum 10-year liability for everything I do. The FAA has not done a decent job updating its noise criteria. Everybody here is dealing with the fact that the FAA is using noise criteria from the Schultz data, which is now 50 years out of date, was probably not good data in the first place, is based on people going out and conducting interviews and not on people responding without any help. We've all come here together. If you took what's the methodology, you almost have a 50 or 80% complaint rate at this point. You should look at that. You should make the FAA explain to you how the Schultz data can possibly apply in the modern world. The second point is that the FAA should do what's obvious to make reduced sound. Planes should go out over the Pacific and not over land. And they can figure out how to track and manage. If they actually collected data, plotted trends, figured out how to get planes with proper holding time, they wouldn't have to race or deaccelerate planes to get them into the airports. They could do this by proper holding times. And if they have to reduce the number of planes by 10 or 15% to do that, so be it. The American public deserves quiet.
Thank you. Abby Samuels? Followed by Ron Rudy and Denise Stansfield and...
Hi.
Go ahead.
I came here tonight trying to understand why everyone's so concerned. So I listened to everyone trying to figure out what the problem was, and I asked the person next to me, and she told me it wrecked her life, that she was waking up every 2 hours. Then I realized I've been waking up every 2 hours. In fact, I have an appointment next week with the sleep clinic. So I wonder if my sleep problem is due to the noise and vibration. In fact, when my boyfriend flies back to Santa Cruz from New Mexico, he told me he can see our backyard. So yes, and it's very low. I'm on the flight path and I'm sleep deprived. So I was so surprised to see the turnout. I'm an activist and would love to see such a turnout for some of the events I help organize. I'm curious, though, how selfish we are. We care about when it affects us, when it affects our peace. I'm not knowledgeable about the flight path, but I really don't understand how changing the flight path will not cause the flights to go over someone else's house. We are so concerned about when something affects us personally. Perhaps this is karma. We get to experience what over 2,000 people experience every single night in Santa Cruz counties, some of them for over 20 years, every single day of their lives. We have laws against the homeless from sleeping here in Santa Cruz. Now we get to experience what the homeless experience every single night when they are woken up by the police or citizens every 2 hours. Yes, sleep deprivation is real. I wish we could be as concerned about others as much as we're concerned about ourselves. Maybe we can have empathy for those who do not have the privilege of having shelter after having experienced a little of what they experienced. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Ron Rohde.
Okay, it's bad. We're mad. You get it. But there's no silver bullet to this problem. And I have zero confidence that this problem is going to be fixed in this iteration or within the duration of this committee. So I'm encouraged by the FAA's commitment in Proposal 5A, which says, FAA will work with the Select Committee to continue, emphasis on the word continue, to address noise concerns in Northern California area. My question to you is, what are your plans for continued engagement with the FAA, and who will inherit your job of engaging with them?
Let me actually.
And I'll take my answer.
And I'll give you an answer. Thank you to the hardcore who are still here. Since this question's come up at least a couple of times, I want to say this. This committee exists only by virtue of the fact that it was appointed by three members of Congress. So we serve at their pleasure and direction. They have made it very clear to us at the initial meeting, which was held at SFO, that they would like prompt action by this committee. They have pointed out that the current administration will only be in place through the end of this year. So we don't know what changes, if any, are in store for the FAA at the end of this year. The direction we've received from the members of Congress is that they would like to see us come back with a set of recommendations to offer our evaluation sooner rather than later, both because people have waited long enough, but also because they're concerned about the fact that if a new administration takes place in January, we could be starting this conversation all over again. That being said, this committee has no expiration date, no sell-by date, but I do think the expectation is that we will do our work, submit our recommendations, and then we are, quote, done. That does not mean that the committee's report back to the members of Congress cannot provide some indication about what we think the longer range needs are. That's a conversation this committee has not yet had. So I know there's not real certainty in that answer, but that is in fact what we have been advised by the members of Congress. We are a creature of the three members of Congress. They've asked us to do it pretty darn quick, provide a response, and then I think we'll see what happens next when we get to that time. But I can assure you everybody up here is mindful of the fact that the world will not be a perfect or perfectly quiet place 3 months or 6 months from now. Okay? I believe Ms. Stansfield has spoken. That takes us to Jim or Jan Tullinen, and Victor Alejandro, and Chris Norton, and Brenda Kiefer, and Denise, you've got a lot of cards in here. And that's all right. Mark Hughes, which is the, and Tiffany Hughes, and Elizabeth James, and that is our last card. So, Jim? No. This is somebody who lives in Soquel on Hidden Valley. Check my handwriting reading. Victor Alejandro, Chris Norton. Thank you, Mr. Alejandro.
You're welcome. Thank you to the Save Our Skies Santa Cruz organization for having a unifying structure for me to channel some of my energy. I moved into Summit West above Scotts Valley, July 2014. When I moved into the area, I was told by a longtime resident of the Santa Cruz Mountains, this is a magical place. Please try and keep it that way. That's why I'm here today. My quality of life examples will be brief, followed by a recommendation taken from my profession. I'm a program manager, and I do software development. Quality of life examples. I agree with the gentleman prior who said it is quiet in the mountains. On our reporting tool, it says loud, loud with capitals, or something beyond that. For me, they're all loud. There's no noise in the mountains at night until you hear a plane every 2 minutes. So please think from a quality of life perspective. I've heard some of these maps don't have cities on them, let alone mountains. So if you are a person with a, I'm appealing to your spirit, your human spirit. Visually, when I stand on my deck, I see the Monterey Bay, the water. Before March 2015, it was uninterrupted. Now I see planes night and day, and at night, their glowing lights, they ruin the black stars. Audio. I used to have barbecues on my deck. Now I can't. You get the idea. There's been a preserved Monterey Bay,
the Monterey National Marine Sanctuary recently created. We're in old growth redwoods overhead. Sorry, my software development recommendation, we take large projects which have long end dates, we break them into smaller pieces, course correction. Please try and do some course correction.
Thank you very much. Chris Norton, Brenda Kiefer, Mark Hughes, Tiffany Hughes, Elizabeth James, we're almost at the end here, folks.
Hi, I live directly under Surfer. I've trained as a pilot in the Bay Area. I've flown all over Santa Cruz County over the years. I trained as a earth scientist. I did my thesis in the Santa Cruz Mountains. Now, the person previously talked about geography, and I think one of the missing puzzles here of hearing from people in San Lorenzo Valley and then hearing from other people talk about the previous flight path not being a problem. Well, I've lived all over the county and under the previous flight path, and one of the answers to why it wasn't a problem is the geography. Specifically, the current flight path goes over an alignment of valleys and ridgelines that are directly in alignment. They're also tilted up towards the summit, and the valley's narrow. And if you can guess by acoustics or just looking at water waves, it's an amplifier system. This is not the same case in the old areas under the Big Sur route. There's big flat areas and there's wider valleys and they're not in alignment with flight path. So that's part of the mystery. It really isn't a mystery. It's that there's a scientific reason for why it is so much noisier, ignoring all the other factors such as how steep the flight or how low the planes are. So thank you.
Thank you. Brenda Kiefer, Mark Hughes, Tiffany Hughes, who's up next?
Hi, my name is Brenda Kiefer. I live in the Summit West area, and I wanted to address a few points. One is this concept of why not raise in place, and I think there's a very clear answer to that, why that is not an acceptable solution to people living in Summit West. We have a layer cake above us. We have Surfer. They jammed bricks underneath it that crosses over my house at only 2,500 feet above ground level. It regularly wakes my year and a half year old child from sleeping in the middle of the night. And as a new parent, anybody can attest that is a nightmare. And we have departures above Surfer. So raising in place is not going to bring any kind of meaningful relief to the people caught in the crosshairs at the summit. I think the goal here really needs to be to reduce the noise to pre-March 2015 levels for everybody. And if you take a data-driven approach to this and set aside a lot of the anger and understandable fear that you're hearing here, I think the answer is very clear. There was one complaint in the entire year before March 2015. We are approaching nearly 1 million complaints just from Santa Cruz County alone if you take the most recent San Francisco data from SFO. So please, please, I think I really appreciate your time working on this issue, but we really need immediate relief. Thank you.
Thank you. Mark Hughes, Tiffany Hughes. Mark and Tiffany Hughes may have given us up, okay. How about Elizabeth James? They have given up. And somebody lives at Jim, Jan, or Jane Tolanen from SoCal. Last call. I tried. Do we have any other cards that have been missed? I assured you all. So what I'm going to do is just ask you to come up, let us know who you are, and we'll get a card. It's entirely possible I missed it, so my apologies. And if you'll just come up, in exchange for my losing the card, we're going to give you the last word. How's that?
My name is Rosemary Hirschbach, and I live in San Miguel Canyon Road. That's Royal Oaks or Watsonville, and it's Monterey County. I am severely affected by the noise made by the airplane jets. Jet airplanes fly day and night over my property and close by. I'm not able to sleep at night, and I'm getting sick from the lack of sleep. And I am also losing weight from the loss of appetite. My property used to be very nice and quiet, but now my whole lifestyle changed. I live up a hill where the noise is louder kind and have the jet airplanes follow a new route far away from my property. As it is right now, my property and surrounding area is used to by jet airplanes as a freeway in the sky. They fly from San Francisco, Oakland, and San Jose airports. Thank you so much for your help in solving this awful problem. And I have a solution to my problem and my neighbors who live in San Miguel Canyon Road, Monterey County. Would be that the FAA fly jet airplanes the old route. Jet airplanes used to fly a route through Granite Rock, Anza Road, Rocks Road, and Freeway 101, all in San Benito County. The FAA used that route for about 40 years without complaints from people because it follows big ranches with thousands of acres and no houses on them. Make the old route permanent and do not fly over my property or around my area. I would be so thankful.
Thank you. All right, folks.
I have a statement. Here's my card.
All right, last one, folks, really? Okay, thank you. Kat Brown.
Yeah, my name's Kat Brown. I live in SoCal. And I have a couple of questions about this select committee. It indicates that it's on South Bay arrivals only. So does that mean that a true regional answer is restricted to South Bay arrivals? That was my one question. The other question is, do we have representation at the round table as Santa Cruz or as the select committee? Could we get representation? My third question is, no budget, no resources. How is it that this committee is going to thrive? And then my last one is, how will the committee communicate with us?
Thank you. And I'm going to try and answer some of those questions because we're going to wrap it up here. But before we do wrap it up, I think people understandably want to know, where do we go from here? So the first thing I'm going to say is we have two more hearings scheduled similar to this one. One is scheduled for, check me if I'm wrong, June the 15th, which will be in San Mateo County. The other is on June the 29th, which will be in Santa Clara County. The format will be substantially similar, although we will have different community-based noise groups testifying, as I indicated earlier. The goal is to get through those three hearings, have heard from all three counties, which, by the way, taken together have close to 3 million people, hear from all three counties, hear from all the community-based noise groups in those three counties. And at that point, this committee is going to need some time, in my judgment. We've not yet had a chance to talk about this, but we're going to need some time then to roll up our sleeves, sit around the table and say, all right, based on what we have heard from the community, what we've heard from the community-based noise groups, what we've received from the FAA, from our own individual meetings throughout the community, where do we go in terms of getting back, again, this was our charge, getting back to the members of Congress and the FAA saying, here's what we are prepared to recommend moving forward based on what you've brought to us. So that's the where we go from here piece of it. And again, in terms of timeline, we have been encouraged by the members of Congress who created us to do this on a pretty tight timeline. We're going to have to deal with the fact that many government jurisdictions are in recess during the course of July. So just as in your lives and at your workplaces, July can sometimes be a challenging month. We'll figure out how to sort that out, but we're going to have to keep making progress going forward. In terms of communication, I'm going to look to the folks from the three members of Congress's offices who are here. They have asked that we provide information as much as possible through their offices. So if you go to the websites for Congresswoman Speer, Congresswoman Eshoo, Congressman Farr, you should be able to access information there. To the extent that we have information, we'll be sharing it with them and then asking them to share it with you. That seemed preferable to trying to have 12 different appointees and their 12 alternates all putting the information up and sharing it in some way, shape, or form. Obviously, individual members are free to share information if they wish to, but if you're asking me, how can you best stay in touch and keep informed, we're going to be working with the three members of Congress and their offices to provide that information. I joked, but not really, at the outset about the fact that we have no office, we have no staff, we have no budget, and we have no authority. But that is, in fact, just technically true. So what it requires is that we all cooperate, collaborate, pitch in where we can, do what we can, which is why I made a point of saying thank you to the county for their efforts in pulling this meeting together, particularly your two supervisors who sit on the committee, also to the county for making arrangements to make sure that this was videotaped so that it can be shared with others and reviewed and re-reviewed, I'm sure, by the members of the committee. By the same token, we had help from the city in pulling this together and hosting us here at the Civic, and up and down the row. Those who serve as vice chairs are county supervisors in their two counties, San Mateo County, where Mr. Pine serves, Santa Cruz County, where Mr. Leopold serves. I serve from Santa Clara County. We have the ability to, I'll just say it, steal a few resources from our own situations to help make all of this work. So the answer to the what do you do is you sort of piece it together and find a way to the greatest degree possible. And we're getting tremendous assistance from all three members of Congress who, you know, in my view, just personal view, deserve a nod for having pulled this process together, having brought the FAA into the conversation, and making sure that there's a vehicle for us to go forward. That being said, we do not have the authority to fix the problem. And while, you know, we're here to, you know, hear your concerns, I want to be very clear. I don't expect you to feel sorry for any of these people because they all volunteered for this job. But I should tell you, they all volunteered for this job. If you talk to somebody from, the school district, the county, the city, they're going to tell you, you know, this really isn't in our jurisdiction. And they're right. But the three members of Congress said, we think that in order to get the FAA to move in a constructive direction, we need to pull together a group of elected officials from throughout the region, not as delegates or representatives from their individual jurisdictions, but essentially to judge, to assess, to be a jury, if you will, in considering the proposals that have now come to us through the feasibility study. So that is our role, and now I'm going to editorialize a little and hope it doesn't set off a free-for-all with the committee. I think there is a delicate balance between charming the FAA and pushing the FAA. And so my hope and my expectation is that in the weeks and months to come, we will charmingly push the FAA into engaging in a constructive way and solving the problem. And my hope, and that's all it is, folks, my hope is that the FAA, having realized they created a problem, has said, we'd like somebody to review and bless this, so if we move forward and there are still unhappy people, we can say they signed off on it. Fair enough. Fair enough. Some of you tonight have talked about the trade-offs. If you do this to benefit us, does it mean that hurts them? Those are the challenges we're going to try and sort out in the conversation over the next couple of months. It's called the Select Committee on South Bay Arrivals because that's what the members of Congress told us it was called. We asked the question at the very first hearing at SFO, are we looking at other airports? And the answer to that question was no, but you can't really talk about what goes on at SFO without acknowledging that it has some impacts on what goes on in other airports. That being said, if we were to tackle, for example, the San Jose airport, I'm pretty sure we've got a couple of members of Congress who think that they would have representatives at this same already long table, probably some council members and a mayor in the city of San Jose. Same is true over in the East Bay. So we are focused on SFO, understanding that it's part of a larger metroplex. I think that's an accurate and fair answer. And with that, why don't I stop and say, last call for any comments or questions from members of the committee, because otherwise we will say thank you to all of you for helping to inform our judgment and our ability to evaluate the feasibility study from the FAA. Mr. Mayor?
Joe, I just have to thank you for getting us off to such a productive and successful inaugural meeting. While it's true, I'm grateful to the Congress people for setting this up and for allowing us to serve. And while it's true we have no authority, I think like with most government bodies, our authority is through the people. And this gives me a lot of hope for what we're about to undertake to get this kind of a turnout. So I want to thank the people of Santa Cruz County for the spectacular gathering and the information you've given us makes me hopeful.
On that gracious note, without objection, the committee is adjourned. Thank you all very much for being here this evening.